In Australia, there's no need to say any more than simply John Farnham. Mr. John Farnham! Mate, first let me say...
Thank you.
Fabulous haircut.
Thanks, mate.
Very
rock star,
a bit taken off.
Yeah, I've had a bit taken off, and I puffed up a little bit at the back, covered the ball bit. And
we'll go into that a bit later.
Oh, yeah, you're right. And if I see the rain, you'll put some echo on this, won't you?
My uncles have always been into music, you know. And I, you know, singing around the Christmas party, you know, everyone would have a carol to sing or something, and it would be a lot of fun. Situation. The two of us. I can always remember they'd all split into harmonies, you know. My dad was always whistling. Some of the fondest memories I have, actually, is driving back from Thornton out here, or this way, or the Goulburn River, going home. And my dad would just sit in the back of the car, just whistling gently while my uncles were driving, you know. And I half asleep. It's a great, and I try to do it to my son. He just turns around and says, "Don't whistle, Dad, you keep me awake."
Can we be people? Could John be someone? Could John be?
I could make Matthew believe that John is anybody that I want to choose.
Give him someone.
When I count to three, Matthew, you'll be wide awake. You'll still be Steve Vizard. It's your show, and we've just come out of a break, and you will believe that John Farnham is Michelle Pfeiffer.
And can I be someone? Michelle Pfeiffer.
If he kisses me, I'll knock him out. I don't care if he's...
She's looking.
Can I be the Queen Mother?
You can be the Queen Mother. And the real Steve Vizard is the Queen Mother. You will see them as the Queen Mother, and you'll see John Farnham's Michelle Pfeiffer. Michelle Pfeiffer, by the way, she's looking particularly gorgeous tonight. She's wearing a cat suit. And you know that she's got the hots for you. Whatever she says, she's got the hots for you, and you've got the hots for her. And you're going to be very flirtatious in your usual way. 1, 2, 3, wide awake.
Welcome back. With me, we've got the Queen Mum and Michelle Pfeiffer. How are we, Michelle?
I'm very well indeed, Steve. How are you?
You've got your cat suit on this evening. And how did you get into that?
This actually is the smallest one I've got. I wore it specially for you, Steve.
Steve, may I... And hold on a sec, sorry, Michelle.
I'm sorry.
We'll interact in the commercial break.
Okay.
And we'll be back right after this. You, It's Tonight Live. Don't go away!
How does it feel when you pick up a paper and it says John Farnham's comeback?
I really don't mind. However it's taken, I'm quite happy that the fact that it's taken. You know, I really... If that's the way it's perceived, then that's what it is.
But it's like you're only as good as your last record or your last century at cricket or your last TV show, I suppose.
Yeah, but that's the bottom line, really. You are only as good as your last performance. I believe that your average also has something to do with that, and I try very hard to keep my average high, but ultimately you're only as good as your last performance, yeah.
But do you feel when you go into a studio for all those months, are you proving something to yourself or to other people?
Oh, I have to prove it to myself first of all. You know yourself that you know, some measure of success or any measure of success that you have gives you the situation where people expect more of you. And I try to
I try to live up to that in my way. First of all, I've got to please me, because I've got to live with it. You know, I've got to cop the flack for it or get the accolade for it, and I know what I'd rather have, but I'm prepared for both, because I like this record. I'm very proud of it. I think it's the best one I've ever made.
What was the word we're looking for that might describe that? Cute? He was cute. When John was little Johnny Farnham, his first bandstand performance right here, probably, Jeff would know, maybe 20 years ago. Since then, he's well and truly cleaned up. Today, he's our number one all-singing, non-smoking superstar who absolutely loves his mother-in-law, Phyllis. So would you please welcome John the Voice Farnham.
For that.
You're good.
Thank you very much.
Hey, listen. But I just got to point something out. The last time you came on, I think the last time, when you actually had to walk through that audience,
yes,
you got your bum pinched.
I did, actually. No, I did. I actually went home with little black and blue marks all over me bum. I was a bit disappointed. It never happened this time.
No, but I better go,
commercial break. I can have a fair bit of fun here today, I think. He said pinch, not goose.
That's mate, we got the guy from the record company on the phone.
Stuart Rubin.
Stuart
Irish
Rubin
works up there, yeah.
Is he? Yeah, Irish. Have we got Stuart?
Hello.
Steve Vizard here, Stuart.
Hi, Steve. How you doing?
Very well, thank you. I asked John before where the record had debuted. And he'd said that he'd got Melbourne, Adelaide,
and Brisbane,
and had come in at number one, and he was short on Sydney and
Perth
because it was a holiday. Have we got the where it debuted for those two cities?
Yep.
Have you got it, Stuart?
Hello, Steve.
Yeah.
Well, I can tell John that we've had the news from ARIA that the album will debut at number one on the national ARIA chart tomorrow.
Mate, that's fantastic. Stewie, I think we should give praise where praise is due. Stewie, you've done a bloody good job with the whole thing.
Yes, sir.
And you've carried the whole album. Stewie, your own marketing skills, Stewie, what do you think you've achieved for John's album?
Sorry, Steve, I didn't hear the question. I'm sorry.
Stewie, what are you doing at the moment, Stu?
Well, we're just having a bit of a dinner with another bit of talent here that's going to be on your show on Thursday. And it's really quite interesting, but we'd just like to say to John, it's a team effort, and I think everyone's helped make it, and including a wonderful singer and a great songwriter that have done it, and great production, and it's music's all about having a wonderful team, and that's what's done it.
Stewie, thanks for those
words.
Thanks,
mate. Appreciate it.
Thanks very much, mate.
John, while that's all very creative, I guess you know you've really made it when you get into the finance and the business magazines. I'm referring to this week's Australian Business and this huge article called The Selling of John Farnham. Fantastic article. How do you feel when you start going from sort of pop star to total business project?
Yeah, it's a strange feeling. Kerri-Ann, how are you?
I'm really good.
Good. I know that, but how are you? No, it's a strange feeling. I read articles like that, sometimes feel like a box of cornflakes, you know, or a lump of meat. I haven't read the article, so I don't know whether it's good or bad. I don't really get into the marketing of the thing. I just do what I do, and I know that things like this and the show that I did last night and travelling around the country as I am doing a promotional tour for the album is basically selling the thing. But I mean, it's a joy for me too. I mean, I get to see a lot of my old mates and go around and see everybody and say hi to everyone, and because I've been around for a long time, so I know most of them. Come back again. I'm just
crazy about you, babe. How is 2006 treating you so far?
It's been good, Richard. I've had a lovely time.
Bit of break?
I'm feeling pretty good. Yeah, I got a bit of a break. I had a bit of a play, and now I'm sort of back doing what I do. I feel pretty excited about it, but I'm a bit toe-y, I must admit. I'm in the middle of rehearsals with the orchestra, so it's, you know, we're getting there.
One of the things I love about you is you still get so nervous before every night, don't you?
Yeah, but yeah.
That's great,
I guess,
though.
So. But it
means you care.
Well, it does. I do care, and it does matter to me. I mean, I guess people expect me to do the right thing, and that's added pressure, there's no doubt about that. So I want to do it properly, and I mean, I got, you know, 100 pieces behind me, and I don't want to screw it up.
Yeah. Tell me about that feeling. As a singer, it must be just amazing.
Get out of my shot.
To jump in front of a big band and have a symphony orchestra chugging along behind you, plus it's, your guys.
It's going to be amazing. I mean, my guys have always been there, and I think I've told you this in the past, where if I make a mistake, and I quite often do, funnily enough, the band will sort of, you know, veer to the left or the right, come back, pick me up, and bring me back. Under these circumstances,
they can't do that.
They can't do that. So I've got to make sure that I know where I am all the time, and that takes a little bit of
discipline.
A little bit, well, yeah, discipline. Yeah, but well, I'm not a very disciplined person. But it takes a bit of my spontaneity away. So I'm trying to overcome that by reading the band's lips. And you know, Lindsay usually mouths all the lyrics. If he ever goes, I'm in trouble.
You know, you can play shows with Tom Jones, you can go out and do the Grease thing, you can do whatever, you can grab a symphony orchestra and do that. I mean, it's a nice place you're in, isn't it?
Yeah, I'm a very lucky man, I must admit. Although I disagree with you, you can't actually go out and just grab a symphony orchestra.
No.
But having said that, when I was approached to do these shows, it blew me away. I mean, I know that they're doing a whole series of shows with a whole lot of people in my part of the industry. And I think it's very exciting, and I think it's terrific for the Sydney Orchestra and the Melbourne Orchestra that they're doing that. I mean, it gets them to a lot more people who would never have heard Beatty Strings zip up, and it's the most amazing, chilling, inspiring sound there is. It's great.
Now, listen, you were pretty lean in those days. Stand up. Have a look at the boy now, will you?
I'm saying I'm fat or I'm just lean again.
Yeah. But I mean, it works.
Well, I
have too many muscles to sit down, wouldn't you?
Yeah, that's always been my problem, though. No, I actually gave up smoking.
Right.
And I got to the stage where I would have eaten a brick dry, you know. If anybody has been smart enough to give up smoking, you know, food tastes fantastic.
Now, we're talking about, 4 or 5 years ago you gave up smoking.
No, only last year.
So you ballooned out, did you?
Oh, yeah, I really blimped out. And so I gave up eating. And that's a lot of fun. You give up smoking and eating. You've got nothing to live for. You know?
Really, oh, there is.
I still have the occasional drink, and Gillian and I are still together. Which is actually surprising, because really, we both gave up together. And that first week or 10 days was really, you know, yeah, I've given up smoking. You want to fight? Because the kids were going. Amazing, you know, the poor buggers put up with it.
But a year later, John, it's no problem. I mean,
no,
you don't miss it.
The only
you
time miss I miss it. No, it's no. The only time I really miss it is I used to love walking around my garden with a cigar and a cup of tea. You know, and now I just walk around my garden with a cup of tea.
I mean, I'm working flat out like a lizard drinking. It's really getting silly. It's that I haven't got time to do everything.
Okay, I'm ready. Let's go.
Beautiful. Thank you, ladies.
Thank you.
Now, that'll put you off your lunch.
No way.
I've also got another problem in that I'm getting 5 and 6 requests a week from people with sick children, and I mean, that breaks my heart. And I'm doing as much as I can do. So that is a great concern of mine, because you can't please everyone. Because if I do it all, something's going to suffer.
Yeah.
And the two things that I will not let suffer are, very first of all, my family, and secondly, my performance. And I'm sorry, that's just the way that it has to run for me. And consequently, something has to go, and it has to be the interviews, or it has to be the photograph session, or things like this. Fortunately, you offered me too much money to knock this back. No, so something has to suffer.
I think the one thing you've got to understand with John Farnham is that he and Jill are two amazing people, and that's husband and wife situation. Then, I mean, they finally had the child, which was so important to them, and they had Robert, you know? Then the next important thing for John was to maintain it as a family.
I'm a leg man, and I saw her pins and thought, ooh, nice. And actually, we sort of developed this relationship over about a three-month period during the show. And I didn't even kiss her for a couple of months. And then when we finally did start going out together, which we had to do very secretly, we, for some reason, naturally started talking about children and getting married and everything. And in fact, I asked her to marry me during the show when I was off stage for about 15 minutes. I ran down to her dressing room. I was feeling good that night. Ran down to her dressing room and I said, I love you. Will you marry me? And she said, yes. I said, oh, great. I'll be back after the show. Really close friend of mine, a fellow named Jeff Reynolds, used to borrow Jeff's MGB. And he'd be at work, and his wife would be at work. And we'd drive over to his place, his home, because we couldn't go to her home, we couldn't go to my home, or my flat, because people were everywhere. And we did most of our courting there. And I had a little 17 and a half foot boat that I used to have moored down at the St Kilda Marina, where they used to call me the temporary Australian, and I used to throw on that, and we'd go out, just go out and cuddle each other for hours.
How do you pick the tracks?
Well, first of all, I look at a lyric. I'm not too precious about the stuff that I write. If I write it, I don't have to record it. Mm-hmm. I get songs from all over the world. And I think people thought they had me pegged with those last two albums, the people that send me songs. And they said, oh, we'll know what he's going to do this time. And they sent me a lot of I Love You, You Don't Love Me songs.
Mm-hmm. And, I'd say you got them.
Oh, I got those. Yeah, thanks.
I noticed that they don't appear on the album a lot.
No, it's not one of yours on it.
No big deal. Anyway, John, you know, all the best with the album and the whole shit.
Thanks, mate. I appreciate that. That's two shits and an arse I'll do so far. Oh, yeah. Oh, shit you.
So, anyway, we were picking... it's fun, isn't it?
Oh, it's great. It's great to be able to swear on the telly.
No, we better not do it. We're going like Grease Lightning, but you just told me that Jennifer Kite heard the album before most people in the world.
Yeah, we were actually at a dinner party one night. Nothing in, I'm not
go easy.
No, Jennifer and I were at a dinner party together with my wife and various other people. And I just happened to have a copy of my new album in my pocket, constantly.
12 of them.
Yeah, and a friend whose house that we were, a friend of ours named David Wilson, and he doesn't have a tape deck. So we went up to Jennifer's place and listened to it, didn't we, Jen?
We sure did, and it was wonderful.
And I don't think you liked it, did you?
No, it's great to see it doing so well, John.
Thank
it's
you.
Fantastic.
Isn't that great?
Nice to see you.
And it's time for the latest news with Jennifer Kite.
Thank you, Steve. Hello, everyone. Well, in just a few hours, Steve, that's our news tonight.
Thanks, Jen. You know the thing with the plane, John reckons since the operation, he's going to do it with something else.
We'll be back.
Stick around. This is live.
Great bunch.
Aren't they fantastic? If we'd have had more time, we're going like the club. If we'd had more time, John said he was going to show us his stitches, but unfortunately, ain't life a bitch. The weather tonight to be presented very briefly, just hold it up if you would, by one of our top visiting Russian models.
Wrong one, guys.
It's the other one, the one with the card. I was an idiot of a producer. Would you thank John Farnham, mate? All the best with the...
Well, they haven't forgotten you, Johnny, and thanks very much for coming in this evening.
The greatest of pleasures, aren't you?
Now, promoting records, it's a very important part of the singer's craft.
Yep.
And let's go back and have a look at the way they promoted Sadie all those years ago. This goes back to about 1914. I think it's the second big show. And here we have you entering the studio with a person impersonating a cleaning woman. I think Louis Richards is on air here, and the cleaner just basically hoovers away, taking most of Louis's rug off there. And there you are, grinning away, and obviously the fag dropping on the record and it's scratching and stuff. And then at a big do afterwards, you had to talk to people who weren't that interested in you.
Yeah,
but at least you kicked on. Now,
Gee, that was fun, thanks.
When you come to Romeo's Heart, I put it to you that you could have gone back and taken a leaf out of the promotion used then to promote Romeo's Heart, and I think you could have gone, you know, similar sales figures.
You reckon?
I do. Roy, I know you had an idea about how Romeo's Heart should be promoted.
Well, I know Glenn Wheatley had a word to me, your manager, John. He was going to rip out hearts out of morgues and send them to people. Radio stations, you know, your 2-day FMs, your Triple M's, your Triple J's, etc. I didn't think it was a good idea. Did you jump on that idea or not? What did you think?
No. He never ran that one by me, no. No, he never ran that one by me.
John, do you miss the microphone?
Although, if we did.
Yeah.
If we did.
Yeah.
I could have used Harry Miller's heart, because that's never been used.
No, it hasn't.
True. Have you? He'd still live, though. That's the funny thing about
that's
Harry.
That's a point. He would still
live. Have you had trouble with Harry M?
No.
No, have you ever been?
No, I just worked for him once.
No.
For a long, long, long time.
Would you ever do it again?
No.
No?
I just mean superstar. No, I'd work for Harry because he's a good player. But it was an interesting career move for me because I think the biggest problem Glenn had with Harry, God rest Harry, but he, I please.
Not that he's not.
No, he's not,
anymore.
But I'm
no, well, they say Harry died many years ago.
That Harry's name was actually bigger than everything else on the poster originally. So we had to bring that back just a frag.
Do you miss the microphone with the lead? Because you used to do it. when the cordless mic came, did that buggy your act? Because
yeah, pretty well, yeah.
Because how much did you practice that? You know, the throwing it up, the wiggling it around.
I used to practice it on the stage when I was working. That kind of thing just happened because I got to the stage, because I used to do a lot of work in the clubs up here in Sydney, and it was very difficult to get people's attention away from the pokies.
Yeah.
And I couldn't do it with my neck, so I thought I'd throw the microphone around a little bit and see if they'd watch. And a few people turned around and looked and said, oh, look at him doing that. And so I incorporated it in the act.
So they had a look, liked what they looked, and thought they might have a listen as well.
That's it, yeah.
Going through a lot of the footage we did for the anniversary special on yourself on this network, the one piece of footage that stayed in my mind, and I think it was the only thing that I really asked to have used, was the wedding day, because when you and Jill married, it wasn't just the marriage of two people who are obviously very much in love, but it was the culmination of so many things for you, because it seemed that every teenager in Australia, certainly female teenager in Australia, loved you. And I thought, I wonder if this is going to be a situation where they won't accept the fact that he's taken a bride. But things got even bigger for you after that, didn't they?
Yeah, I guess I was naive enough or silly enough to think that I could, that people would be happy for me. And it was strange in that a lot of people were, and a lot of people never forgave me for it. I still get people coming up and saying, you, I hated you on that day, you know, which I'm grateful for in my way. But no, I was very lucky in that, you know, people accepted it fairly well.
And the bottom line,
and I never hid the fact that I was getting married or I was in love, you know.
And she's so important. I mean, it's a great love story, isn't it?
Oh, Gillian's great. She's my strength. She really is my strength.
Glenn's over there. G'day, Glenn.
Kelly Spider.
He'd be a very happy man.
See, I told you I'd get you on the Visage show. Not a problem.
He'd be a very happy man too, wouldn't he? He'd be delighted.
Yeah.
Now, is it true that you forget the lyrics of songs that you're singing?
Constantly. I'm notorious for it.
How can you do that when you've had songs that you've known for years? How can you forget them?
Yeah, well, I tend to get a bit toey when I work, if you know what I mean.
Yeah.
And I actually go blind and forget my mind. I lose my mind. I'm basically an airhead. That's the truth.
So we've got an airhead.
Yeah, I'm basically an airhead.
So you cannot... But give us an example. All right, let me just give
you... Okay, I'll give you a perfect example. The other day, I was in Sydney. And the record's been released, and I was doing the rounds, doing promotion and radio interviews and television interviews and stuff. And the Brashers people, the chain of Brashers stores, were having a ball in Sydney, and we thought we'd drop in on it and say hello.
and there were, you know, 300 or 400 Brash's people there. And they happened to have a band on that night, and there was a piano, and my party trick is help. That's the only thing I can play on the piano, so I thought, I'll do my party trick. And I swear, and this is where I was ashamed of myself, I couldn't remember the second line of the song.
How many times have you sung that?
Millions of times. Millions of times.
Is that why you would go, everybody?
You can laugh. That's actually how that stuff happens for me.
Yeah.
I make
everybody.
Yeah.
Sing it. Yeah. That's why you do that stuff.
Yeah. It's true. It's true.
Does anyone here actually sing Sadie? I guess you don't, Rick, do you? No, John, if everyone sings along with you, would you sing Sadie? Do you want to hear it? Come on. Just for your mother-in-law, come on.
No. Oh, not in front of me, mates.
Yeah, come on.
Anybody starts throwing up, you're in trouble. Oh, you've embarrassed me in front of my mates, right?
Oh, no, I haven't.
On national TV.
Go on, get into it.
Okay. If you sing, I'll sing. You ready? I can't believe this is happening. I'll do anything for a bit of rain. Oh, Sadie, the cleaning lady. See, they all know it, though. With trash, this rubbing brush and pail of water. You're rolling the credits. Works her fingers to the for the life she had at home. Providing at the same time for her daughter. Come on, Ray, you got to sing. Sadie,
the cleaning lady.
No, forget it, Ray, I'll sing. Her aching knees not getting any younger. Well, her red detergent hands have 4 years not held a man's. And time would fight her heart in spite of hunger.
But I mentioned as well, I mean, the other thing apart from giving up the cigarettes is that you go to the gym every day.
Yes, I've started to, yeah, and it's been good for me. I've never done anything like that. I mean, you know, when I work, I slim down a little bit anyway because I tend to perspire and I'm fairly speedy anyway, so my heart rate goes through the roof and I'm running around and going brrrr. So that tends to drop weight off you. But I've never ever been to the gym or anything like that, and I'm actually running now. I never thought I could. I'm using both lungs, that's what it is. So I'm actually running and doing a little bit of bike work, and it's great fun.
But as a young plumber and so on, you didn't play football or cricket, you weren't heavily athletic?
No, I never really had the time for that. I was in a band at that stage, so yeah. I was too busy learning lyrics. To go, thank you very much indeed, Jeff. to go and play football. It's funny, I've had a good piece of news about this project every day since the day I gave it to Wheatley. And they have all that positivity to work with has been just unbelievable. It's been unbelievable. And I've got to say, I'm enjoying success more now than I ever did in the past, purely because I'm able to understand it a lot more. I feel a bit more credible within myself because, you know, I when it first happened, I never really worked at it at all. But I feel after all this time that I've worked at what I do, and it's nice to get something to happen with it. But I've no concept of why it works. All you can do is do your best. And hopefully capture people's imagination with it. That's the bottom line in the end.
Are you still off the fags?
Yep. Yeah, I'll never smoke again. Except for the bloke up the back. he said, do I want to go out for a smoke? And I said, yeah, why not?
But I mean, are you still working out?
Yes, I am, but it's not working. I'm still working out. I'm very fit, but I'm finding it very difficult to lose this little spare tire, large spare tire that I have around my waist. But it took me 44 years to get that, so I figure it's going to take a little bit of time to get rid of.
Do you ever bug at many mics?
Many mics. Yeah. I'd hit them on the ground and the ends would just
when
come
you were
off.
Doing the round the world, yo-yo style.
Yeah, when I was doing round the world. I walked the dog a few times with it. That's what fixed them up, I think.
I hate to tell you, but you're responsible for this. The fact we're here was because you said you'd come.
Yeah, well, you asked me.
I know.
No, I'm very glad. I mean, I wish we didn't have to be here. I mean, we all do. We've also. It's been amazing backstage today because we very rarely see each other. And yes, all right. No, please. People ask me to take my clothes off. This is a family show.
No, but we very rarely get together, and it's the feeling backstage is fantastic, that we're all back together again and we're doing this whole thing together, but we just wish we didn't have to be here.
When we did the Rwanda concert, John paid $500 for my tie.
I got another one. Oh. Now, hang on. Now, did your mother-in-law give you that? Because you wouldn't buy one of those yourself,
would you? No, that's you. That's I thought you were basically green.
Okay, well, I tell you what. If you will sign that for me...
Yep, no question.
...and sign that other rotten yellow one... I reckon the yellow one was better than this one. But
how much? $1,000?
I'll give you $1,000. All right, I'll give you $1,000 for that. Okay.
Righto, well, I'll match you. I'll do $1,000 as
well. All right, you're on.
You're on, okay. $1,000 each on that.
This is a little band, Sydney.
I remember this day. It was unbelievable.
This is for Bandstand?
Yeah. And it was actually in the very...
What are you doing?
Look, I've got bell bottoms on. I can't believe it. This girl, I never caught this girl, by the way. I've got to tell you. Oh, yes, I did. Just the once, though.
Do you know who it was?
No, it was the cameraman's daughter.
Sure.
Look, I did. I still hadn't had a haircut. I still look like a wingnut with short back and sides.
All right.
Amazing to see.
When would that have been? Early 70s?
Yeah, very early.
We can help you. Yeah. No, you've never seen that since those days.
No, I've never seen that.
Who do you think is the most fun you've ever worked with?
You want to answer this question very carefully indeed, dearie.
That sounds like a familiar voice. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome John Farnham.
Before you answered that question. And I was trying to think of a way to impersonate Wallace, but I couldn't do it. Now, I bought my Sandy doll. But I'm a little disappointed because I would have preferred Sandy 2, which is in the tight bracket. But the beauty of this one is there's a few moving parts. But I left her in the box because I didn't want to wear them out.
Haven't changed a bit. John? Just
don't get me into trouble, because this could go much further.
Just so that you don't feel left out, we have your own doll.
I thought I was going to get away with that too. Oh, gee, thanks very much.
That one only works if Glenn Wheatley's handling it, mate.
Queen Mum. And the lovely Michelle Pfeiffer. I don't know why she's not sitting next to me, but anyway.
Well, that can be arranged, I'm sure.
Can you tell me about ventilation and sweat?
Sweat? Well, what happens?
What do you do with it?
Can I
have it after you finish?
Certainly. I'd like you to help me wash it off, Steve.
Michelle, come on, look, this is live television. You can't be asking me to do things like that on live television.
It's okay, are you married?
My wife's probably watching, of course.
Oh, okay.
She loves me dearly.
Right.
Do you?
But, yes, I do. I want you in all sorts of bad ways. I can't stand it anymore.
I don't know why I'm holding this up. I have no idea whatsoever. Back with Michelle and the Queen Mum.
Michelle,
good on you, dear.
Are you angry with me? You're not angry with me, are you?
Sweetie, I'm not. Okay. I couldn't be angry with you at all.
I brought my whip with me.
Sleep. One account to three now, you'll be wide awake and you'll be back to Matthew, your normal self. You know what the bloody hell you're doing there with your leg over John Farnham. Okay. 1, 2, 3, wide awake.
Hey, mate.
John, who listens to your material? Do you have somebody else who...
Well, I listen to it and get involved in it, but, yeah, it sometimes is hard to be objective, and you really get to the stage where you can't see the trees for the forest or the forest for the trees, and so... It's not just me. Like, it's a big team. There's Ross Fraser, who's my producer, Glenn Wheatley, my manager, Doug Brady, who's our engineer, Phil Buckle, who wrote a lot of the stuff with us. And if we can't make all of us happy with something, then we change it, you know, with no compromise. You know, there might be something that three of us like that the other two don't, so we'll get it so that we're all happy. Ultimately, if there's a lyric or there's something that I really... can't do with any conviction, it's gone, because it ultimately comes down to me. But,
sure.
But I like to have the team involved. You know, I'm just the one who gets the most light. I mean, it's all of us together.
Please don't ask me
Please. Yes. I actually know that. Do you know that?
Please don't ask me.
I know that.
Please don't ask me.
Okay.
Could you do it?
What, okay.
You
actually do know this, don't
two
you?
Two flats?
Yeah. No Z demolished
ladies
in
and
this.
Gentlemen.
I don't sing jazz.
Ladies and gentlemen. Go,
please don't ask me.
Ladies and gentlemen. It is now my great pleasure
like
to
this.
Introduce... You sure you
want
to go with this?
Not really, Steve, but I'll give it a shot.
Ladies and gentlemen, it is now my great pleasure to introduce a thoroughly rehearsed, thoroughly prepared version that, frankly, I think is going to do this album wonders. Version, Please Don't Ask Me, John Farnham, Paul Grabowski.
He knows it. It's going to be interesting. Nice. No, wait for me, Paul, because I come in before you do that chord.
Same as the record, you do it?
Yeah, but basically same as the record.
Okay,
sorry.
All right.
Pardon me. I'll sing Sadie if you're not careful, and you don't know that one. Shut up. Please don't ask me why I'm so in love with you. Get a Z demolished in front. Jazz chords. Fabulous. No, just the one. Thank you. I'll get you for that, Steve.
Instill national pride in our children, but please let's make our national pride encompass humanity. Thank you very much indeed.
Australian of the Year and Born Again success story, John Farnham has taken good and bad in 21 years of rock and roll. 1988 is his year, and the performances at Expo the highlight of a long career.
Jesus, what a night!
John Farnham is Australia's best-loved performer. His new album, Age of Reason, is set to break the records of its brother Jack.
John Farnham, thanks for joining us.
It's a pleasure, Andrew. Thank you.
You had people waiting, queuing up for your concert yesterday at 10 o'clock in the morning. 4 hours before the concert started, it was totally packed out. That's a lot to live up to, isn't it?
It is. It puts a lot of pressure on me. But I'm very grateful for the fact that people really want to get there and see the thing. And I did see it on the news. And I did thank them when I finally got there. But, no, it's pretty daunting to know that the place was full up at 4:30 or something.
Do you know what it is that makes people do that?
No idea. No
well,
idea.
You must have some idea.
I mean, the record's been a hit, and you know, people were coming to the concerts, and I guess that thing sort of rolls like a snowball. But I don't know. If I'd have known what it was.
But why is it snowballing? Why? I mean, have you ever asked yourself? Here I am, John Farnham. My God, look what's happening.
Oh, absolutely. Every morning, mate, I wake up. I don't believe what's going on. I woke up this morning, I was on the front page of the newspaper, with positive things said about the concert last night. That is absolute joy. I can't tell you what a joy that is. I love it. And what I say as well is that, I mean, the thing that success has given me, I've been very lucky. I've been successful for quite some time.
And a few times.
That's true. I mean, this is my second bite of the cherry. And
the most important one?
The most important one. And I've got to say, I'm enjoying it more now than I ever did.
Because you understand it
well,
better?
Well, yeah, I understand a lot more about it. I have a lot more control over the circumstances under which I work. And what the success has given me is the opportunity to do it under the best circumstances I can, with the best people I can.
See, what I see with something like this, mm-hmm. is that it's not a taking sort of thing, it's a giving you're giving out.
Well, I think it
and that's what people are reacting to. Do you see it that way?
Possibly. I don't know. It's not a conscious effort. I don't sort of really go out and set myself up an image or anything like that. It's not really the way I work. That's what you see is what you get, and that's basically it. Obviously, these things are marketed in the best possible way.
Yeah, sure.
And they really try and do that, but I can only give what I've got to give and give it in the best way I can.
All right, what are you giving?
As much of myself as I can.
All right.
I love to do it, and I love to get back what comes back.
All right, but what is yourself? See, I mean, I look at Age of Reason, for instance, and just looking at that clip, for instance, mm-hmm. and all the kids there.
Yeah.
I mean, you've obviously changed since having kids.
Sure. Oh, yeah. Well, I think that's been the biggest change in me. It has made me... Because when I was running around the country as a pop singer, I really only had time to think about myself and think about what I was doing. And I saw someone quoted on the television the other day saying, we only really borrow our time on the planet from our children, because they're the ones who end up with it. And that just keeps going like that. And I look at my kids and I think, well, gee, why, with all this common sense that we say we should have, are we still killing each other? It's bloody stupid. It really is. It's dumb.
Yes, we're supposedly intelligent human beings, and look what we're doing to ourselves.
Yeah. Yeah.
All right, so what sort of world...
Look what we're doing to each other, too. You know?
Yes, indeed. Which gets us onto the Australian of the Year to a degree.
Mm-hmm.
What are we doing to ourselves?
We're mucking up what we've got. I mean, this is the only place in the universe... I mean, this is a bit brown rice and hairy legs. I don't mean it that way. But this is it. This is it. You know? I mean, there's a hole in the ozone layer. That's crazy. We know what things create that. And we must stop all that stuff.
All right. So what sort of world are you through things like this and what you're saying in songs like this? Because I listen to the words and I'm sure a lot of people...
It's the first thing I look at.
So what is it, the message that you're trying to get through? I mean, you talked about positivity before.
Yeah. Positivity, yeah, sure. And look at what we're leaving behind us for your children and my children and everyone else's children. We're leaving them a dirty, great big mess, you know. I think we should clean our act up a little bit.
Anyone else in the family, apart from you and Jilly, who've given up cigarettes recently?
My mother and father gave up.
Your mother and father?
Yeah, the dragon doesn't smoke anymore. Actually, where she lives, there are two women about her age who smoke, and quite heavily, and they could barely walk. I mean, it's a real shame. But I've offered to pay for their cigarettes for the rest of their lives if they can get Phyllis back onto it. I know, it was a fairly good deal. $50 a year, get rid of the dragon. I'm in like a rocket. Okay, that's out of the way. Next.
No more mother-in-law jokes, right?
I don't know any new ones, right? That's the problem.
Well, you're also doing these shows with Stevie Nicks. How's that going to work? You're going to do separate sets?
Yeah, we're going to do separate sets. No, we're not singing any together. I have yet to meet Stevie, and I'm looking forward to it. I'm working on my whirling dervish. I'm working on my moves. no lack of respect there. I think she's terrific. But it's going to be fun. Most of those shows are in New Zealand, but we're also doing one
Perth,
in Perth, Brisbane, and Adelaide.
Yeah. Well, it's a double bang for the buck,
yeah,
isn't it?
Yeah, it's going to be fun.
Yeah, terrific. The album is... gone gangbusters. With the symphony orchestra, are you only playing stuff from the new album?
Oh, no. There were liberal sprinkling of the stuff off the new album because they're beautiful songs and they have lent themselves beautifully to what we tried to do here. But no, I'll be doing stuff that people expect me to do, orchestrating,
of course. You've got to do
You're
the Voice.
Oh, I have to do You're the Voice.
You get lynched if you didn't.
Yeah, I get lynched if I didn't. And, you know, it's so much more fun to sing than Sadie.
You're doing Sadie?
Yeah, no. Thanks for asking, though, Richard.
Not with the symphony orchestra.
No, hey, listen, I've got the jazz version, not that I want to be a jazz singer, but I've got the jazz version of Sadie the Cleaning Lady in my mind that's a killer. I'll do it one day just for fun.
When you look back at that young guy singing Sadie, I mean, with the benefit of hindsight, if you could have had a word on his shoulder knowing now what you do, what words of advice would you put in his head for the journey ahead?
Oh, gee. Well, this could take a while, Richard. When I do see
stuff from that period of time. It actually is like, I call, it's like somebody else. It's somebody else. I talked to Glenn about it, and I call him E. He's somewhere else. I don't know. Look, I'm not ashamed of the things that I've done over the years. There are things that I've done that I'm not particularly proud of. Having said that,
you wouldn't change
from a
thing.
Professional. No, you know what? Because that's brought me to this very moment, and I've enjoyed it.
I'm going to get you inside soon before you melt, but I just...
You know, John, the interesting thing about your career, so many people purport to have a well-managed career, you know, time themselves nicely and do this, then have a rest. But you really are the ultimate in that. I mean, you come on the scene at the right time, you have your album, you do your concert tour at the right time, Jesus Christ Superstar was at the right time, and you really do drift back into the shadows for a while. How hard is that to plan?
Well, I just like to get out of people's way for a while. You know, it's a dead giveaway when people, as you walk past, when people start going, oh, you know, so you sort of get out their way. But that's what I wanted to do, and nobody, because nobody knew that Superstar was going to work like it did,
yeah,
except old Harry,
mm-hmm,
you know, and I thought, oh, this will be good, you know. It won't do anything near what Harry thinks it's going to do, and it's not on the stage under my own steam. It'll give me a chance to get out of the way for a while.
Sure.
But Harry was right, you know.
He's usually right, isn't he, old Harry?
Yes,
sir.
You went on the Red X Bash,
yes, sir,
in 1991. Now, we hear about you being a great driver and what a terrifically good driver you are.
I bet I know the bit you've got. The Iron Man.
Let's have a look at it. Let's have a look at the sequence of photographs hitherto never seen anywhere. Now, this is a car that you're in?
Yes, number five, car five. Mm-hmm. There we go. Buckle up in the bush, yep.
Buckle up in the bush and...
Yeah, yes, I knew you'd pick this.
Now, there's a couple of Iron Men. Now, just explain... who they are.
Yeah, I kept my shirt on. It's not a pretty sight, I've got to tell you. That's Grant Kenny and Trevor Hendy.
Now, there's John's car. You can't see that properly, but in fact, that car is completely dented.
Yeah, I rear-ended two Iron Men.
Well, Phyllis rang Jeff earlier, and she actually said Jeff some music, didn't she, Jeff?
She certainly did.
What was that called?
Yeah. A piece of B-flat called Please.
B-flat called Please.
Please don't.
Please don't ask, but it says here, would you ask John, to sing this as I love him very much? To I the Dragon.
That's from my mother-in-law.
From
Phyllis.
From Phyllis, yes.
Oh, Phyllis.
Is that a good idea?
I don't know whether I can. Well, we could try.
Would you like to hear John sing?
No. I didn't tell him to do it. I said, I'd try. I don't know whether I know the words. It's been a while. I wasn't prepared for this.
I didn't do my warm-up.
It's really strange because I haven't... I can do the act now. So...
Come on, back out.
No, no. I'm trying to remember the bloody words. Oh, you've really put me on a spot.
Sing along with it.
Because I haven't sung for a while. Here we go. I'm just getting in the mood.
Now the end is sorry.
No, don't you dare. So we're doing Please Don't Ask Me, right, Jeff?
Yes.
Well, play that one then, will you?
Put it right on, please.
I get him every time. He won't talk to me for another year now. It's great.
But if you have an album that doesn't work, how do you justify that to yourself later on? Do you blame other people or do you blame yourself?
No, blame myself. No, there's no... The buck stops right here. I mean, I'm ultimately responsible for what I record, the way I record it, and how I record it. I mean, I'm very lucky, and I believe I've been smart. I've surrounded myself with some of the most talented people in the world.
How is Jill?
She's particularly... Yeah, right. Well, you've pegged that in one. I mean, Jillian Wonder Wife, as I prefer to call her. No, she's great, but she is my strength. All those people, it's a team thing, and I try to draw from those people their talent, and they make me look good, you know, and that's not false modesty at all, but I'm very lucky in that success has given me the opportunity to do what I love to do under the best circumstances, and that's great, you know.
Do you look back on some of the old days? There are many old days now for you, for example, and
many
I mentioned Tom Piper simply because we've got some of the footage,
right?
But is that almost another person for you?
Yeah, I actually look at that stuff, and I must admit, Gillian watched the special.
You haven't watched
I've never
yet,
seen
Bart.
It.
Right.
And it's really strange. When people ask me all the time, I don't think I could watch my life flash before my eyes and not die at the end.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? It's a really scary thought. And I actually do sit there sometimes when I watch a television show or something will come on and... Or I'll do a show, there's a wiggle, a gag for you, and this old stuff will come up. I really do sit there and go, look at him, look, and it is someone else.
Mm.
It's not, it's just, I mean, it's just me then. And people say, how have you changed in 25 years? And it's like saying to a 25-year-old, how have you changed since you were one?
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
So I've grown up a lot. And I was talking to one of the girls in the makeup room this morning. She said, look, I've got this gel put around your eyes, you know. Get rid of some of the wrinkles. I said, no, I worked really hard for these.
Mm.
You know, I was pretty for years. I'm quite happy with this.
I'm glad you left it there for me.
We used to come up here a lot when I was a kid, or, you know, 14, 15, with my uncles, my dad and my uncles. We used to go up to Thornton, or fish to Goulburn. And it's stuck with me, you know, I've always loved it. It's just a nice place to get away. I love it up here in winter. You know, it's cold and it rains. It's a pleasure. It really is. It's a lovely place to come. I'm very lucky with things like this. I can cut it off completely. It gets a bit difficult sometimes, like you know, a boat goes past and somebody happens to recognise me, then... It sort of tends to get around a little bit and I get boats from everywhere that'll come over. And that makes it a little bit uncomfortable. Not that I mind. The first time I went into Channel 9, I was walking down the corridor and Eric Pierce, was then Eric Pierce, not Sir Eric Pierce, was walking towards me and I felt as if I'd known the man for as long as I could remember. He'd been in my lounge room reading the news every night and I said, oh, hi, Eric, how are you? And I mean, I went up and I apologised and said, I'm sorry, Mr. Pierce, I don't know you. I just felt as if... And people feel as if they know me, which is very flattering.
Yeah.
And they don't really see past that. You know, they don't realise that you're having a day off or whatever. And I understand that. So I make sure, or I try and make sure, that when I do get away, I get away. So I'm not put in an embarrassing situation of having to say to someone, I'm sorry, I'm having a break. And I'm not putting them in this position where, you know, I have to be rude to them.
Now, look, you've received many awards over a very long career and you've been crowned and acknowledged many times. And I think one of the finest, you know, looking at the research for this, was when you became King of Moomba. And you had a go at promoting Moomba, the Moomba Festival.
Yeah.
Now, I should explain for people who don't know, the Moomba Festival is a March festival in Melbourne. It's usually played out over the long weekend.
It's actually just been on.
It's just been on, yeah. Unfortunately, it's been overshadowed a little bit this year by, you know, the importing of three tenors, ordinary three tenors, and Grand Prix and so
which
on.
Which is actually a great sadness, I think, because Moomba was always such...
Fun.
A fun thing.
And what does it mean? What does Moomba mean? Does it mean let's get together and have fun?
That's exactly what I'm thinking for that. Yes, yeah. That's what it does mean. I thought it meant boomerang, but no, that does actually mean let's get together and have fun.
Yes.
And but it's a shame that it's not televised anymore. I mean, the whole thing.
Well, the whole thing.
That's not the whole thing. But they used to have the parade down the street.
Now here you are as King of Moomba. I think spruiking the
promote. Which isn't a very nice word, really, but get Moomba as well known as we possibly can, nationally. I was very surprised to hear on the radio a little while ago that a lot of interstate people didn't know what Moomba was, you know, and Melbourne is very, very proud of Moomba.
That couldn't be right! That couldn't be right! Just
those
people didn't know what
Moomba
was.
No, they didn't. What
are
they, just scratching
their head?
Yeah,
they we'd
say Moomba and they go, what?
Yes.
You know.
Please don't ask me why I'm not talking. It's
very long, this song, isn't it?
Just can't explain. No, please don't ask me why I go walking. Out in the rain, I could not live. Mind would change to have you near would be a mistake. Please don't ask me why I'm so in love with you.
Let's do that bit again, Jeff.
Do on the stage. If it doesn't get out the front, it's all over. The wind's come up, Brad. You see the ball patch? It doesn't really. Crunch. Doesn't really matter how well we do what we do. If it doesn't get out the front, it's all over. And we have, the best lighting and sound people in the world, I believe. And they're also nice human beings. They're good people to be around.
Two Johns with me. One has Australia's best voice, and the other one is probably one of Australia's most loved gentlemen. Welcome, John. Welcome, John.
Thank you, Murray Lewis.
Tell me, do you consider yourself betting men?
I'm not really a gambler. I think I'd put the dog, the car, the house, and everything on. I don't have the courage to do it properly.
I do. I do put the dog, the house, the car, everything. And I'm about to do the same again. I work because I lose so much gambling, and Johnny works. Yeah, well,
I have to.
Yeah. And I tell you what, the man is wearing a smile, but he has been up since 5 o'clock this morning.
Yeah, actually, I was up so early this morning, I thought I was going fishing. I started digging worms out of the pot plants.
That's right.
Sorry.
Now, why were you up at five? Any particular reason? Was it a...
Well, I'm on the promo
thing,
trail. Yeah, no, not a bladder thing. That's usually at four.
Oh.
I'm on the promo trail. I got this album came out and everything, and sort of just doing the normal thing, doing all the radio programs. And
you got 5 o'clock tomorrow again?
Yeah, actually, no, it's not so bad in the morning, tomorrow morning.
At 5:30-ish? It's,
yeah, I think they've got me up at 7.
Oh, that's so pretty generous.
It's not
what time does Glenn Wheatley, your able manager, get up? You're up at 5. What time does Glenn up?
Glenn wakes up about 20% later than I do. I think about...
20% later?
About 20 past 5. You know.
Now, what's this ribs thing? I heard that you...
I fell off a boat. I was fishing with a mate up in Queensland.
Sober?
I hadn't even opened the esky yet. Really, I promise. And I slipped off the side and really crunched my side on the side of the boat. I was going up the pointed bit up the front to set the anchor up at the bow, and just a little 17 footer, and went down. Oh, and really took the wind out of me. I got back on the boat. We went fishing, and I caught, I think it was 56 mackerel between about 40.
Yeah.
Well, it might have been 60, I don't remember. And, they were between 40
and 50. This is with a near broken rib.
With a near broken rib at that stage. Of...
Extraordinary.
And I was in a great deal of pain and...
Nothing like the fish, mate.
Yeah, right. Oh, but, I did a little bit of fishing. Then I came back. I was only away for 2 weeks. I came back and it still hurt. It hurt for about 4 weeks. Oh. It's a shut up now, okay? It's not
Let's
working.
Let's not push it.
Yeah. And then, thanks very much, Paul. And then
I came back and I was mixing up some concrete at home, and I put the mixer on a couple of bricks because I couldn't get my barrow under it, and I didn't want to let the tyre down, you know. So, and it slipped off the bricks, and I leapt to catch it. It went to fall, and I, well, you know, fooled. Oh, I'll catch it. And it was full of concrete.
A full barrow?
Yeah, and they went further.
Must be one of the few people in the world who's leapt to catch a full barrow load of concrete. Very stupid thing to do in retrospect.
Yeah, I couldn't believe it, you know. Well, I mean, I've got kids, you know, and you tend to leap when things heavy fall over just in case they're around. Of course, they were at school in the kindy, so...
Now, I watched the John Farnham 25 Years, now called Australia's Favourite Son, the other night, and you see Farnham through all the periods. I've known you a long time. You hide the lows very cleverly, don't you? We never see you down.
Yeah, but I don't... I mean, I don't want to dwell on that. I also don't want to dwell on the highs either. I haven't seen that program. I didn't watch it the first time, and I didn't watch it the second time. I don't feel the need to see my life flash before me and then don't die at the end. No, really, it's not even that. It's just that I would squirm constantly and incessantly all the way through something like that. I just want to move onwards and hopefully upwards, you know.
Honey, I guess it's easier to handle success when you've handled failure. I've certainly found that to be the case. You know, we're looking at you now at the top of your game, and yet I guess a few years ago things were pretty bleak. Did you ever say to yourself, you know, I've got to get out of this business, you know, I've just hit the pits?
No. What I have said in the past, and I say again now, is that if it ever becomes a job for me, if I ever lose the love of it, I'll give it up. I'll do something else. And that's whether I've got a dollar in my pocket or whether I've got nothing in my pocket. I have to like what I do. I'm just that kind of guy.
Are there two John Farnhams? But I mean, you love your family. I guess the picture of you, though, to everybody else is a pop star. Is there almost like two of you?
Well, I don't think there is. I mean, I'm probably a little schizophrenic in my way. I mean, I can sit down and watch myself on television, which is something I do rarely. But I mean, at one stage, my wife called me and said, look at him. And so, I guess, seriously.
That's your father, is that what you're saying?
No, it is a kind of a strange thing. But I don't go out of my way to be any different when I'm working than I am when I'm not working. I mean, I'm pretty well open about what I am and what I'm like. The thing I protect most of all is my family and my privacy.
Jack, how bad was the quiet time?
Oh, it's pretty bad. But I never really dwelled on it. In fact, I think the worst time I had was after I'd finished recording Whispering Jack.
Right.
Because during the bad time, I had to get my backside into gear and go and earn some money to feed my family. That was a bit soul-destroying and a bit debilitating, but I still did it. And every time I sang, I loved it, you know. And I'll never forget when Glenn and I finally got together. I was working in Queensland at a club somewhere, doing a cabaret show in a frilly shirt and a dinner suit, you know. And he actually ceremoniously got it and ripped it up when we'd finished the thing. But after Whispering Jack, I'd put so much time and so much effort into that. Mm-hmm. I mean, Ross Fraser and I worked for 18, sometimes 20 hours a day, 7 days a week, putting that album together. And I got to the stage where I couldn't give it any more. There was nothing I could do, and I had to say, it's finished now. And I'm very grateful that it worked, you know.
Congratulations.
Thanks, Ray.
Long overdue.
Well, I don't know about that, but I thank you for that. It's been a hell of a year for me. It's been just great.
You said last night, the best year of your life.
Yep, absolutely. In all sorts of ways. I mean, you know, the best thing, of course, that's happened this year is my wife is pregnant again. And
when is she due, John?
She's due in January.
And the little boy is now...
Robbie's 5 and a half.
Right.
And the devil incarnate. He's great.
I just reminded John, in fact, of the... some years back when I was in 60 Minutes, we crossed paths in Los Angeles catching a plane home. And Robbie then was, I guess, only about 2 and a half, mm-hmm. and running around the airport in Los Angeles. And he was running from mum to dad, back to dad, back to mum. And John just stood there and looked at him and said, he's so beautiful, I could eat him. He's so... Is he still that beautiful?
Yeah, oh, I could suck the meat off his bones. I love him. He's great. He's got this thing about his clothes. He will not wear baggy jeans. You know, you want to put the kids in hip clothes and things. And he said, oh, no, Dad, I don't want to wear those. They're baggy. I want to wear me scummy jeans. I think he got that off me. And I said, look, you can't... We were having a fight the other day, just playing, and his button popped off his shirt. And he said, oh, Dad, I'm going to have to go and change my shirt. This is... My button's come off. And I got annoyed with him. I said, look, you cannot keep changing. You can't change 3 and 4 times a day. Your mum's got to pick up all these clothes. She's got to wash them and everything. And he just looked at me and said, Dad, that's the person I am. And I said, no, you're quite right. You go and change. It's fine with me. How do you argue? How do you argue with that? It's great. He's 55 years old. It's frightening.
Now, Whispering Jack has turned 40. You've obviously changed your lifestyle. It's the first time I've spoken to you in years when you aren't threatening to give up smoking. You've done it.
Yeah, I've done it. And I know you, and you used to give me hell for being a smoker of any kind. And I'm grateful for your input for that. I mean, but I didn't give up for you.
Oh, sorry.
And I didn't give up for my kids. I gave up ultimately for me. Obviously, my kids are a big influence in that. I mean, the boys are much better off because I don't smoke.
But you had a crutch there. You used to say, I dare stop smoking because my voice will change.
Yeah, well, that was an excuse. You know, I'm a pussy. What can I say? No, it was an excuse. I mean, I got to the stage where I wanted to give up, and nobody will give up unless they want to. And I mean, I don't want to become born again about this thing, and people seem to be interested in the fact that I've given up. And if I can encourage anybody not to smoke or encourage anybody to give up, I'd like to be able to do that.
Mate, something is wrong with my baby duet with
really?
Barnsley. No.
Oh,
sorry.
You had me worried.
Sorry. No. Literacy.
might have been a hereditary thing, you know.
Something is wrong with my baby. The song, of course, that you've done with Barnsley, is going through the roof.
Yeah, I'm.
Is that a
really,
technical term?
No, it's pretty average.
Yep.
Pretty average term. No, I'm very very pleased. The way it's been accepted, and it's interesting because Stuart Rubin, and I'll drop his name here, Stuart from my record company, who's the managing director. And originally, when I'd recorded this piece with Jimmy, we were going to do a reciprocal thing. You know, Jim was going to put it on his album and I was going to put it on mine. And Wheatley and I talked to Stuart and he said, oh, no, he said, I don't think it'll be a hit.
Won't be a hit. This is how much of a hit it won't be. Definitely won't be a hit. I'm talking to John Farnham. We're going to take a break. We'll be back with John after this. Stick around.
John, this new album of yours, I don't know whether this is a good analogy, it must be like having a baby. There's so much to it, so much pain, and in the long run, so much satisfaction.
Well, I think you probably... That's a good analogy. I've seen my wife have 2 babies, and I understand exactly what you're talking about. I felt under a tremendous amount of pressure while I was making the album. And I think the pressure is now coming to a head because, you know, I have to sort of hand it over to the people to make their decision on whether it's going to stand up against the last one or whether it's going to stand up at all. But I have to take the attitude with things like this is when I make the album, I have to do the best I can do and walk away from it as happy as I can be. And then it's easier to accept the success or failure.
Yeah, but it's been interesting with the lyrics and stuff. And I have an apology to make to you, a public apology to make
What's
to you.
That?
I never really got to work with you on the album.
I know. Well,
which disappointed me, and because I was in the middle of my one at the time, and I've become terribly self-possessed, and I can't pull myself away from an album once I start it. And but are you finished?
I am finished.
Oh, well, next time.
Next time, I'd love that.
Well, pick a day when I'm not working,
thank
will you?
Thank you. All right. Well, thank you for that. That's really nice. Because I did miss you.
Yeah, well, I miss you too. Yeah. And because I love singing with you on the show. And I got a kiss at the end of each song, which was kind of nice.
You still like to tour, though, don't you?
Very much.
Get out there on the stage.
I think that's my favourite part. That's the payoff for me, is to put the band together, get it all together, and perform live. That's...
That's the be-all and end-all. That's the joy for me. That's where it all happens.
Do you look 10 years ahead and say, what'll I be doing?
No. I never have. I mean, they used to ask me 20 years ago what I'd be doing in 20 years' time. I didn't know then, and I don't know now. I don't know. I mean, that's why I had the photograph taken on the album cover, which I promised to hold up to the record company, laying down, because I didn't have to use the walking frame. It was nice.
Ride me horse, I'll give me horse help. Gillian doesn't want me to stop. She said, yeah, you're not going to stop, are you? And I said, no, of course not. Oh, there are things that I will do, but I don't know that I'll tour for a while after this one.
Get to know your mother-in-law better?
No, I don't want to know the woman at all. probably won't go near her. he sucked me into this every time. And because I go home and she says, you know, all my friends sit on Santa's lap. Yes, I can be in that. but she says to me, you know, all my friends ring me up and tell me, you know, the things you've been saying about me. And, of course, they elaborate. It's fantastic. She sees everything I do, you know. Don't you, you dragon. She'll be sitting up there going, oh, that's my son-in-law, which is great. But then her friends ring her up who don't think she's seen it. And she said, did you hear what he said about you? And she goes, no, what? And, of course, it gets worse and worse, which is great.
John, I noticed in the clip of the song, you on top of the world, literally with your feet super glued to these rocks. Is that how it was?
Well, not really. I did feel on top of the world, I must admit, but they flew me up there in a helicopter at 7 o'clock in the morning. And what we were looking for was those valleys to be covered in mist, and they were. And we were looking for a spot to land for 20 minutes to find a hole in it. We found a hole and they said, now, what are we going to do? We can't land on this thing. They flew me around it a couple of times. They said, we can't land on this thing. What we have to do is put one skid on the rock and then the other one will be dangling in the air, but don't worry about that. And the pilot said, now, when I nod, he said, open the door and jump out, but jump out smoothly. So they put a skid on the rock and I jumped out. I think it's the smoothest jump I've ever made. But I was standing on top of this thing, singing my heart out and feeling very emotional about the thing because it was really an amazing view.
The entire song, Glenn Wheatley over in the corner there, yeah. He's singing along there and every bar he can see the record sales just going up there.
He's got the second worst rhythm of anyone I know.
He looked like he was dancing to some other song.
It's like this. I mean, I can't watch him. I tell him to keep out of my line of sight, but he's actually, you know, I'll be doing the thing, you know, of course. And he's going.
That's pretty much what he was doing.
He's absolutely unbelievable. He has to stay out of my line of sight because I can't go on.
Without laughing.
I really can't go on. No, I love it. I'm very grateful. I mean, I've been very lucky. I've had some really good successes and some serious failures. And I think I've learnt from both things. You know, personally, I'd rather learn from the successes.
Success, easy to live with.
Easier, much easier.
Past, you keep doing albums that seem to outsell the previous one and outsell the previous one. Do you worry, seriously, about how do I top that?
Yeah, every time. I mean, it's like the old thing. I mean, you're in the same boat where you have some success, and the more success that you have, the more is expected of you, which is the way it should be. So, you know, you try and give that something else. And I try not to make, you know, Whispering Jack Part 1, 2, 3 and 4. I want to make each album different from the last album.
John, the one thing I want to ask you, and I suppose in some ways it's an unfair question because it's a very hard thing for you to do, but let me phrase it this way. I talked to a couple of co-stars of yours in Jesus Christ Superstar, and one particularly who hadn't worked with you all that much, John Stevens I'm talking about, and I mean, they all said, apart from the great talent that you have, and we all recognise that, what a pleasure to work with you. Now, it can't
they're
be...
only young, they're
but,
all young.
But it can't be an act. I mean, where does it come from, this combination of professionalism and also the fact that you are a good bloke?
I'm not insecure, Bert. It's not brain surgery, you know. It's music, and I'm not insecure about it. I know I can sing in tune. I don't see this as a competition. I'm not in competition with John Stevens or Jimmy Barnes or Daryl Braithwaite or anybody else. You know, I'm a singer. I'm trying to do the very best that I can do at the time. And if I can help someone with the years that I've spent doing it, I will, you know? And if I can't, I won't. But it's honestly that simple. I'm not insecure about it. I enjoy it. I'm having a wonderful time still doing it.
Seemed like a good idea at the time. Obviously, is your idea to get the D-Gen involved in that videotape?
Yeah, I'm a big fan of those people. And I think they're very, very funny indeed. And I was very grateful that they did this for me. I mean, they did a thing called Five in a Row, in where they sent us a whole lot of pop stars up, and I was one of them, and I begged them if I could be in that clip. And of course, when I rang them up and said, look, have you got any ideas for this clip,
They were fantastic. I wasn't calling in a favour, I just wanted to do it. I could see you doing this.
You think that's me, then?
Yeah.
Do you?
Yeah.
Billy
Ray Martin.
Billy Ray Martin. Yeah, just what I need. Yeah.
This is, Santo's grandfather. He came in, Santo's grandfather's 86. And he was talking to me in Italian. I know what the hell he was saying. I'm a nice man, but it turned out that he was telling me that I should play the piano accordion if I wanted to make it overseas. Just a lovely man.
It's great. You play on this album, you play the percussion on a couple of tracks.
Yes, I do. Steve, what, do you want to talk about that? Oh, fine.
I didn't know you were a drummer. You are a drummer.
There's a gag in there. I'm not touching it. I actually have been a frustrated drummer for many years.
Mm-hmm.
And it's only until recently that I developed some rhythm. But it was great because when we were recording the album, Ross Fraser and I actually owned a recording studio. So, you know, if I didn't get it right the first time, I could do it again. If it took me 3 days, hey, who cares? So it was great to have the time.
Now, who wrote all the songs on this album? Let's just deal with it.
All sorts of different people, really.
Just hold it up for camera two there.
Thank you so much. There's some stuff written by Phil Buckle and Ross Fraser and myself. There's a song with Ross Wilson there, a couple of with Richard, who I prefer to call Skid.
Skid?
Skiddy Marks.
Yep.
Listen, I'm not. That's the last time I'm explaining one.
Yep.
And John Stevens, there's a song with John there. A couple of bits and pieces.
Mm-hmm. Now, you say you're pretty tired, but I believe you're on a health kick at the moment. You're on a get fit kick?
I am on a get fit kick.
Tell me about that.
Great. I mean, it's given people the mollies now. I said to someone very early in the piece that I'd given up smoking. Oh, really? And of course, it got lobbed and jumped upon. But I have given up the fags, and I'm actually feeling fantastic.
Could you be a farmer like Jeff? Could you retire and become a farmer?
No, I don't want to put little small furry animals down my trousers for a start.
So. I can't do that.
I can't live down, Sadie. You got the ferrets.
What happened to the ferret, Jeff?
Pardon?
What happened to the ferret?
I've got to play Sadie for him. He keeps that up. I think it died of some mysterious disease, didn't it?
But so you wouldn't run the farm, although you like to get back
there
and relax?
Yeah, it's not a farm as such. It's fairly small, so it's not really a farm. It's just a couple of big paddocks, which I really love. But there are other things that I'd like to do. I'd like to try and develop some other people, help some other people's careers, and not in a management aspect. I couldn't do that. I couldn't do what Glenn does. You know, I can't dance like that for a start.
But, how does he dance?
Oh, you watch him. You get a shot of him later on.
He dances.
He has to stay out of my way.
Yeah. So
you're a good dancer, aren't you, Wee?
How does he dance?
Oh, it's really quite remarkable. I mean, I'll be singing Burn For You, right? And I'll burn for Don't You Dare. And he'll be going... Oh, come on.
John, it's my pleasure to, it's been a 5-day wait. Can I give you a double platinum album as well?
With the greatest of pleasure.
There you go.
Oh, that's nice.
Thank you very much. I'm trying to be subdued, but that's blown me away.
That's extraordinary.
And it wasn't set up, was it?
No.
That's great. Thank you for that.
And that's 5 whole days.
I'm a happy old man. Yeah.
That's extraordinary. Yeah, and of course, you go on tour in the immediate future.
Yes, we start the tour. I leave as the ball gets bounced on Saturday for 3 weeks in Europe as a promotional tour. Oh, shut up. And I'm going to go over there. I'm in a different country every day. Oh, no, I'm sorry. I'm in London. 2 days, so I get to wash my underpants in London, which is quite a bit of fun, actually, after you've been on the road for 3 weeks.
You sort of look forward to it.
I usually do it while I've got them on, you know.
And now, one of the songs on your...
Think about it. Put the soap on the inside, away you go. Whoa! Sorry.
They had that photograph. They had me laying down in the photograph because I didn't have to use the walking frame that day. It was
last chance. We've got to... Yes, ma'am. In the orange.
Are you going to... Are you going to branch into acting again?
Oh, I'll probably take up a bit of acting, yeah. Doing something with Mel next year. No, I can't act. I'm not really much of an actor, honestly. Oh, no, hang on, no. Oh, please. No, I'm more of a buffoon than an actor, I've got to tell you. But thank you for the compliment.
Yes, ma'am.
Oh, this is from... Thank you, Sue Ellen. And a phone number as well. Ho, ho! STD, can I call you reverse charges, love? Do you mind if I pull the head off one of these, if you'll pardon the expression? I'll just... behave. Hang on, I'll just... That's what annoys me. Oh, it's all right for you. That's all right. I just got to be careful I don't catch apis. Little gardening joke there. Oh. Thank you, darling. Thank you very much. Oh, dear. What's your name, Stacey? Thank you, Stacey. But you held it too tight. You killed it. No, but it's all right. Oh, so it's okay, Stacey. I'll give it a drink. I want another. Thank you so much. This could take 3 hours, you know, with any luck. This is a stiff one. This is fine. Behave. Hang on. Hello. How you going? Oh, look, a teddy bear. Thank you very much, darling. Thank you. You know, it's funny. This reminds me. Oh, no, it's an elephant. Sorry, an elephant on a stick. Hang on. I'll just put these. It's a shame, isn't it? I've been there. You know, I mean, what I meant was, if you don't water them, they die.
Loading up, I am. I don't normally do this because there's very valuable equipment about, but
I love being on the road with these people. They're great. Yeah. They're all totally enthusiastic. They're all totally into what we're doing. They're getting a real big kick out of it. And so am I, you know. And there's 34 of us, I think, with the crew and the band. And we spend every waking moment together as well as when we're working, you know. So there's always a party on in someone's room somewhere at some time.
Already. I love my life.
Oh, a very cool entrance, John.
Sorry I was late. My chopper was a little slow this morning.
You had me worried.
Nah, really?
Yeah.
I've been trying to worry you for years.
I wish.
Yeah, right.
Hey, listen, how about that adulation after X number of years in the business?
Well, I pay for the taxi. I pay for the taxi. They should give me something back. Oh, it's fantastic. It's good to see them. There's a lot of faces I recognise there, too. They come to some of the shows. It's fantastic.
There's posters and flowers.
I think Ross Fraser, my record producer, and I spent about 3 weeks listening to material. I get songs from all over the world, which is really nice. I mean, and when I decided to make an album, we usually let all the publishers know that we're looking for material, and everyone finds out that we're looking for songs. So I get them from the bloke down the road, as well as, you know, the publishers in America and England and all over the rest of the world. So I listen to everything I get just in case, because I don't want to miss out on anything. And it's a good example. There's one song on the album called Don't Let It End, which is a beautiful ballad. It's a great song. But it was written by a young fella who's never had anything recorded before, who lives, you know, a little bit away from the studio. And he dropped it in one day on the off chance that I might have a listen to it. That's on the album. And then I've got a song by Sheryl Crow. So it's from one extreme to the other. It's really good. If you heard the last album, you'd realise that I'm not a particularly good songwriter. And,
Oh, is that why
No, I'm only gagging. Get off me. This time I just wanted to approach it differently. And we were going to call... we wrote this song called Second Skin, because at one stage we were going to call the album Second Skin, but fortunately we came to our senses and called it Romeo's Heart instead.
Oh, a beautiful title,
yes,
too.
Yes, much, much better. That's a true story, Jeff. You've got to laugh out of that.
I wasn't going to enter into that one.
Yeah, but he just wants a shot. You know what he's like. Take a photograph of him, and then it's over and done with.
What was it called?
Hello, sir. How are you?
I'm very well.
Good, good.
Please don't ask me.
Now, one of your passions in life is riding horses, cutting horses, and it's something you share with wife Jill.
Yes. Well, Jillie and I mean, there's a lot of things we share. one of them are the horses. Look at the size of that bum. Did you see that? And so, yee-haw, Rodham County. Yeah.
But, I mean, it's a fantastic... A lot of people go and play golf together. You and Julie go ride together.
Yeah.
And this is actually from the weekend, a very large weekend, launching the
album. Yes, we were up in Bowral, and unfortunately you couldn't make it because you had stuff to do.
I was in Perth for the Appeal-a-thon. But how long have you and Jill been married now?
Well, I don't know. 1973, so I guess...
Do you remember the anniversary?
Very well, every one of them. Because I got it made. See, her birthday is on March the 11th, and our anniversary is on April the 11th. Mm-hmm. So I get warning, fair warning, of both of them. Although I did blow up one year, and this is true, I actually bought Gillian a crock pot for our first... Yeah.
I mean, you may be John Farnham, if you bought me a crock pot, I'm sorry.
Yeah. No, well, she just looked at me, she said, okay, this is great, where's the Vaseline? Just think about it for a minute. Because he's a dainty little thing, you see. He's a spade, if you know what I'm saying.
Well, but Jilly is such a good woman.
Oh, she's a great
woman.
And she's a good
terrific.
Kiss for a girl, too.
A good kiss for a girl.
But her mother, on the other hand, is a bit of a worry.
Had you tried other things before? Well, what did you do to give up?
I've given up. You see, you've never been a smoker, have you?
Never been a smoker.
Yeah, well, I have, obviously. I've smoked for years and years and years, and I've given up 15, 20 times. But you won't give up until you want to give up. It's just like anything. If you want to do it, you will.
So you didn't do anything particular, it was just pure willpower?
No, just cold turkey, no patches, no gum or anything like that. I set a date. And I was talking about to one of the guys, Mike, before,
yeah.
And he said he gave up smoking several years ago and still craves one badly. And he believes that is because he never actually had his last smoke, which I find, quite amazing. But I guess I went through that. I had my last smoke on the day I designated, and I haven't smoked since, and I'll never smoke again. It was great.
Right, and you haven't for 1 minute wanted another.
Oh, I've been through a situation where I'd love one. I miss it walking around the garden with a cup of tea.
So if I was to offer you a smoke,
no,
wouldn't even. And what about Jillian? Is she all right?
Jillian's fine too. She will never smoke again, and it's great for the kids. The kids are going to live, and the kids are thrilled.
Folks, watching the show this morning, if you want any indication of the sort of regard this bloke is held in, I mean, I know that Australia loves him, but within the industry, quite often there are people who are loved by the folks outside, but inside you'd like to wring their necks. There's a girl called Sue Grange who works occasionally on this program on AutoCue, and she particularly had herself... There's a photograph taken with Sue at the Logies. Come over, Sue, and say hello to
John. You're going to embarrass her.
Come right over. She's just had a baby. She's still madly in love with Jack. Just come over and represent everybody by giving him a cuddle. There you go.
Well, that's very nice. Thank you.
Take a nice shot off it. There they are together. Good on you, Sue.
That's lovely.
Can you stay? I'll be over and I'll sit on your lap in a minute. Yeah. Is Julian out of town? Is she?
No, she's watching right now.
Is
I'm a dead
she?
Man.
You're a dead man. Thank you, Sue, for coming over.
Thanks, Sue.
See you later on.
There you go. And as I say, she represents everybody in this industry. John, congratulations on the new album.
Thank you, Bert.
Great to see you.
Thank you. And you.
Johnny, you've been described over the year in two ways. I know many regard you as the finest singer in the world, and you'll get no argument here.
Thank you, mate.
Yeah, but you have been described as someone who oversings. Do you think you oversing, say, in comparison to, say, someone like Glenn Shorrock, who just sings the crotchets and the quavers and that's it?
No, I do.
You oversing?
I do tend to overdo it a bit. Fortunately, I'm trying to work myself out of that. Mariah Carey oversings.
Yes, she does.
Because she can, I guess. And I thought that I could, but I can't anymore. But I pulled it back a little bit. I used to try and do everything I could and get every note out of out of the thing as I could.
Well, I think that's what people enjoy, the over-singing. But when you were, say, with LRB, did you have people like Graham Goble and his other half-baked mate, bloody Birtles? I can't work those guys out at all. To my mind, they're cod ordinary. I've had trouble with them all my life. I've never got on with them. Are you of similar mind, John?
No, not really.
You just hope their guts.
Yeah. No, not their guts.
No.
But, we actually don't...
Talk
much
no,
lately. But no, I don't have anything against them at all.
No.
But I don't spend any time with them either.
Was it difficult sitting into an ensemble like that where they were doing the harmony and they would have wanted you to be right on that bloody note at the right time? And you as an overseer, you would have bloody hated that.
Hated it.
Hated it. Because what was happening, I found that difficult because I'd been a solo performer all my life. And joining a band, and it was in, I was in a situation where I had to... I love to be a team player, as long as I'm the captain, which is fine. And that's just the way I work. And of course, that was a little difficult. I felt very restricted within a band. In that, you know, often the material that we were recording as a band wasn't what I felt comfortable with, but because the other five guys liked it, or four out of the six of us liked it, then I had to be in it. I guess it's like being the managing director of a company and having to sell something you don't really believe in.
What happened?
It's funny. When you're in the bash situation, you're dealing with dust this deep, and you're going about 80 mile an hour through these things. And you know, Grant and Trevor are pretty competitive human beings, you know. I mean, they really are quite competitive, and old Wheatley and I like a bit of a run around a bit, and we're fairly competitive in that circumstance. So what we must have been a kilometre in front of them. It happened to be my turn to drive this particular day, thank goodness, and we were doing real well. I mean, we were taking them out. These boys were behind us, you know, girls, you know, we were out of there. And then Wheatley gave me the wrong direction. You did. No, come on now, I'm the one. No, you did. You dance, I'll sing and tell the jokes.
No. So, we were following the girls, if I remember correctly.
No, we were too. We were catching up with the girls, and they took a left and we followed them. What can I say? And Hendy and Grant got in front of us, and which really annoyed me. And so it took me ages to find a way around. Actually, he did give me the wrong direction, but I think.
But with Richard Marx as well.
Yeah, Richard's a friend. In fact, I saw Richard a couple of weeks ago, and we were talking about the ballad that he has written with Phil Buckle, and he called me back about this thing, because Richard and I are good mates. And what had happened was he sort of played the melody line, this keyboard part, to this ballad and just hummed it on the tape. And I put it to one side, loved it, it was beautiful, put it to one side. And Phil Buckle said, what's that thing that Richard given you, the ballad? And I said, well, I haven't really listened to it. And he came back 3 days later with the finished lyrics. So I never wrote it. They wrote it while they were apart. But it's a lovely song, beautiful song. It's typical me. I mean, I love to sing ballads anyway, but it's a beautiful song to sing. And no, I'm not going to sing it now, Jeff.
Phyllis didn't send the music.
No, Phyllis didn't even get it. I'm not even going to give her a CD. she can take it off the radio for all I care. And then I'll sue her. We were in Europe, and You're the Voice was quite a big hit over there, so we went over with the next album, Chain Reaction. No, Age of Reason, I know that. And we went over there to...
And the next act.
Yeah, right, to do some promotion for it, and I was singing Age of Reason live on this television show in Sweden, I think. And we were taping this thing, and halfway through it, the floor manager came up and said, look, I think we've got a problem. I think your manager's having a fit. That's a true story, I swear. He was doing... It's unbelievable. It's really... that's a true story, isn't it, Wade?
Yeah.
That's great.
Your ex-manager's not smart.
Yeah, right. No, I've got to give him some hell. He's working me hard lately.
So this is your new album.
Yes, sir.
I'll hold it up. Now, that is, in fact, a whole lot of live stuff that you've done.
Yeah.
Now, why did you choose to go and get the live stuff together when it would have been so much easier to do a best of collection album, compilation album? A lot more work for a man of your advanced years.
No, thank you, Steve, for bringing that up.
That's okay.
I was asked actually by the record company and my management, Glenn, to put the live album. And I was a bit disappointed because Ross Fraser, my record producer, and I have got a partnership in this recording studio that we've just fixed up. You know, and it's got the 72-channel SSL, and we've really done... And I wanted to play with it. You know, I wanted to go in and play with the studio. But they talked me into doing this thing, and I'm very glad they have, because it was interesting putting the thing together. I mean, there's no post-production on it as such. It's all warts and all. There's a couple of glaring lyric problems on there that I'd rather live without.
Can you identify them for us?
You can't miss them, Steve. They're there.
What's your favourite song from the album?
I don't really have a favourite song. My usual answer to that is it's like asking someone with 16 children which one he loves the most, you know. Yeah. I sort of like them all, otherwise they wouldn't be on there.
You get a live album like this that's got so many of your great hits on it. How do you pick them? I mean, you've sung numerous songs over the years.
Obviously, I wanted to get stuff from the last three albums on the record because, you know, that's really what's been happening for me in the last 4 or 5 years. But a couple of the old ones really came up well. I mean, one I recorded 22 years ago, the song one.
Yeah, what was it?
And
Yeah, it's an old Three Dog Night song that I ripped off them.
Yeah, which one's that?
The early days.
That's Sadie, One. You knucklehead.
No, it's After That's Freedom. It's actually called One, O-N-E.
One.
Yeah.
Well, One. One is the loneliest number.
Yeah, One is the loneliest number. Yeah. But I can be doing a show somewhere, and or be giving a talk. It could be anywhere, and Gillian will be in the ladies' room because she's seen me do it so many times. And one of my favourite stories is she was in the ladies' room one time, and I was doing a show. This is well before Whispering Jack, and she was in the ladies' room, and these women were in there. Two women were in there, and one was saying, "Oh, don't you hate him? Oh, he makes my skin crawl." Gillian's telling me this story. I think she was embellishing just a little bit. Makes my skin crawl. Well, she, you know, she can't help herself. Oh, really? I love him. And, oh, how can you love him? He's so nice. Doing all this stuff. See? And Gillian said, "Oh, no, I really love him. He's terrific and everything." And the woman said, "How can you love him?" She said, "Because he's my husband." And I mean, that's a serious put-down, you know. She's good at that.
Now, I do this with fear and trepidation here. You were at the Variety Awards,
yes.
And a wonderful award that you got, which I have written down here. The Variety Lifetime Achievement. That's big stuff. Now, pretty folks, nice. just have a look at this. I want you to explain.
And, well, I've had a drink. But Kerry's here somewhere, and I'm sure if she was here, she'd let me look at her legs. She's my friend.
Now, what would Jill have said to that?
Well, she would have said, "You look awful, John." But she knows I'm a leg man, you see.
Well, why
and
I've
turned
pants
up today, and here you are in a pair of trousers. You know?
Well, I mean, so, I could change.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, no, hang on a minute. Now, I'll take the challenge on that. You reckon
well,
you
what are you going to do then?
You
okay,
first.
We'll figure it out. Girls, could you actually... The girls here in the front have got a wonderful gift. Girls, right. Bring up your thingy-jig. Can you handle this?
Are you going to change?
I'm going to be back. I'm taking the challenge.
All right.
Come up here.
Okay,
now, can you look after my audience well?
Certainly.
You know, I don't want to lose them. It's taken me a long time to get this gift. There you go.
Thank you, ladies.
Now,
that's nice. I love my work. Okay, I'll open up the box. Oh, look, okay. Well, this is it. Open up the box. Oh, my nails are just broke. They pegged me as an animal lover, I think. That's very nice. Thank you, ladies. I'll put that down here. Yeah, absolutely.
See, I've got my legs on now. If John Farnham asked me to see my legs, look, they're back.
They're back.
And have you got all the goodies?
Yeah, I've got my goodies.
Okay,
I've
you keep that. And
thank
girls,
you,
there you
thank
go.
Thank you, ladies.
Thanks, girls.
That's really, can I take
please, thank you. You were very brave.
Thank you.
Woo! Isn't that sweet?
Oh, take a seat.
Yeah. How did you enjoy that?
Take a seat so I can see more of your legs.
Okay, I've got my legs. What are you doing?
Oh, you're sitting on the bloody flower.
We've got...
See, no...
But what I have here for you
roses.
Is your skirt. You people have been actually very, very generous today. Oh, ladies and gentlemen. And that was worth waiting for.
I've been spending 25 years trying to be taken seriously as a musician.
But look, all the other graft and corruption you've got today, that's a great hat. That is a cool hat.
Showbiz, this is my life.
Yet, with So Long in Love, it's obvious, I mean, that one's genuine for me. I mean, we've been together for 20 years, been in love with her for a long time. She's a good kiss, you know?
Good.
And
good
oh, there
kiss.
She is, Superwife, Wonder Woman. Because she was terribly embarrassed about that particular thing because they came out with the promos and said, you know, John Farnham's Wonder Wife comes out of hiding. She answered the phone as Wonder Wife for the next week. She's great fun. She really is. She's good fun.
Well, see, so, I heard stories that you liked
you know, with a corded mic, you liked having a bloody long lead, 50 or 60 metres, and really going out and working the audience, because you love being with the audience, relating to the audience. Now, I heard that the gobe and the beeb actually bloody stapled your cord down so you couldn't move anywhere more than about 3 or 4 metres away from the X on the stage. Is that true?
Pretty, yeah. Well, apparently so. I've heard myself. I heard the same rumour. But it was really interesting because, you know, we're touring America with that, because everybody thought I was Glenn Shorrock. Mm-hmm. Hey, you agree, Glenn? I'd say, thank you very much. Which was good fun. I had a great time. Because
yeah.
I thought I was Shorrock.
Did you two-bob detail cars and do something like that? Maybe
but, some nights I'd have, you know, 60 foot of cable, and I'd be working my backside off, you know. And then the next night, there'd be 6 feet. And I'd go to take off, and I'd end up, you know, like a cow being roped at the end of it.
Now, your album is going gangbusters, John. We should congratulate
you.
Yes,
I love it.
Of course, thank you. And you recently played Kahuna?
Yes, I played Kahuna.
Where you were discovered?
Yeah, I was discovered there, if you could use that word. Uncovered would probably be
better.
A better word. But yeah, it was a unique experience for me. It was absolutely sensational. Everyone from the local area turned up, and it was it brought back a lot of memories. Some were good, some were bad, but it was unbelievable.
So now you're the big Kahuna there. I didn't mean that.
Look, Richard's right there. Yeah, sure. And in red.
Big Kahuna. They've been trying to get you back there for years, haven't they?
They have.
How are the horses?
They're all very well. In fact, it's foaling season as we speak.
How gorgeous.
So we're having foals, and it's actually quite lovely. And I get to name some of them only if I'm really quick. And I just had a foal by a horse called Doc's Freckles Oak. And the stallion's name is Doc's. He's a Doc's Freckles Oak stallion. And so I called the foal that I've had from him my freckle, because I can't wait to go out on the road and for the judge to say, and here's John Farnham riding my freckle.
I mentioned Sadie there, John. I guess last night and this year, as you can now put Sadie in perspective and say, well, she was important, she was fabulous, but she's in perspective now.
Yeah, I mean, that was 20 years ago. Sometimes it feels like 27 years ago. And I'm not embarrassed about Sadie the cleaning lady at all. I don't apologise.
What about these photos? Are you embarrassed about
these photos? I'm embarrassed about these photographs, yeah. Yes. Oh, yes. That's a beaut.
No, you're really embarrassed.
Oh. I've still got that suit. My son wears it and it's got no buttons on it.
How old? Well, you would have been 17?
No, actually, I was probably in my 20s there. Seriously. And I saw a friend at the airport yesterday. He said, you look awful. I said, it's great to see you again. And he said, how old are you? And I said, I'm 38. He said, you look older. So I snotted him.
He's no longer a friend, eh?
Yeah, right.
What happened? I mean, if you look back between The King of Pop and Whispering Jack, the success album, what happened there?
Well, I'd done all sorts of different things. I mean, I got to the stage just before I joined the Wheatley organisation about 8 years ago, where I wasn't being stimulated by what I was doing. I was sort of still singing Sadie and Raindrops that I'd done 10 years before, mm-hmm. still trading on those things and not moving forward in any way. And I wasn't being stimulated. I don't think it was particularly stimulating to the audience that I had, even though there was only 9 of them at the time.
Seriously.
So I decided that I'd pull my socks up, as it were, and stick my neck out.
Sorry, were you actually doing clubs or doing pubs where there was only a handful of people?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Hard to believe.
Yeah. In fact, there were less than a handful of people at a couple of the places. I remember going back to do a show in Dandenong, which was the place where I lived when I was a kid. And, you know, all my family came along, and that was it. None of my schoolmates came around. I was mortified. But I still enjoyed myself. I mean, I sort of still got paid for singing. Not very much, but I was singing. So.
Some of the great tunes that you've recorded over the years, but I put it to you that On the Border is the worst song anybody's ever recorded in this sort of music. I mean, I know it's a boffin question, because you have to know the song, but it's a heap of rubbish, Roy, isn't it? How did you feel when the manager came in and said, Glenn, as they called you then, of course, because he thought you were...
Glenn Shorrock. Yeah. Yeah.
Glenn, yeah. Have a go at this, mate, if you don't mind, and don't walk
around the stage. That ends with the, you're out of order.
That's it.
Because order rhymes with border, I suppose.
Yeah, that's exactly.
Is that
right.
One of Beebs or Graham Bloody Gables?
Yeah. But he, actually, that was a very big hit. It's not one of my favourite songs. No. I can appreciate the work that actually went into some of those songs. Yeah. I wouldn't choose to record that. But I was in there. Yeah. I joined the band and it was my fault.
I think Roy always stresses to young people coming into the entertainment industry, you always have a trade behind you, and at least you've got something to fall back on, and that is plumbing. I understand you keep in trim with the tools every other day. What are your favourite jobs in plumbing?
I don't know that I had a favourite job, but I was an apprentice for 2 years.
Right.
And so I really learned how to roll my sleeve up real quick.
And you would have been digging drains?
Digging drains,
did
unblocking.
You use
so I can get my arm, still get my arm up an S bend, no problems whatsoever. Yeah.
Did you ever wriggle out a drain with an eel?
Yes. Yes. It's called a roto-rooter.
Roto-rooter, yes.
We used to put that through the drains if it got clogged with roots.
Yes. Yes.
You get the old roto-rooter.
Because you've got three different types of appendage you can put on the end of it.
Yeah. Well, we call them attachments. I'm going to put my appendages on it at all. Nowhere near it.
20 years of marriage, how have you managed to fool Julie all this time?
Fool her?
What?
Well,
I'm not going anywhere.
There's a few things that come to mind, I've got to tell you. I taught her arithmetic, so I think that just think about that. No, we get on very well. She's her and Gaynor have gone away for a week together. They wanted to go to a health farm. And I spoke to Julie yesterday. She won't be watching this song, Safe as Houses. Unless you play it over and over and over again. I rang her yesterday and said, are you enjoying? She said, I hate this. So, I'm glad she's having a great time. Because I had to iron my own shirt and everything. And actually, I was telling someone today, I had an amazing experience in Red Square. Uh-huh. I got really pissed. I got quite intoxicated. In Red Square, I was drinking brandy, and I like a drop of brandy occasionally, and Wheatley was with me. He had a couple of sips of it too, and it was snowing, and he was trying to take pictures of, oh, look, snow.
Of snow flying
right
way down.
Yeah. And there's this lovely flash shot of all these bits.
It would have been a great roll of film.
Yeah, what is this?
So what do you do now? Do you simply go around and promote? You're not going to do a concert tour?
Not unless I have to come back here, no.
we could organise that.
No, the concert tour will be in February, March. So I'm actually really looking forward to that, but I have to get out of the way. I mean, Madonna's coming out and everybody else. So I'm going to get out of their way for a while, and I'll come out in February, March, when I can get it all together.
I've got, we've got a million questions, we can always talk, but I thought the audience might have some questions you'd like to ask John, but just think about it for a second, hang on guys. I want to show a clip from,
are you ready, boys?
Yeah, no. Actually, let's talk to the audience then, Alex, we'll go there. No, we'll change our mind.
Alex, talk to Jeff.
Yeah, let's go. Yeah, Jeff.
I have a question.
Oh, Glenn's had something to say. Let's talk to Glenn.
Let's talk to each other.
Let's have a clip, though.
But did you feel, what about the frustration? I mentioned week before last, when we had Kerry Bedell on, and I was saying to certainly the band and Jeff and the musicians, have always, in my experience, they've always said when they talked about great Australian voices, they would say Kerry Bedell is the musician's lady singer.
Absolutely.
And you were the muso's male singer. So, I mean, did you find yourself frustrated saying, look, I know I've got the voice, I know I can do it, why can't I crack it?
No,
You should have.
Well, this is not to make light of what's happened for me in the rest of the world over the last 12 months, but it really hasn't been the most important thing in my life.
The success, you mean, this pinnacle.
Yeah, what's happened here, the fact that I've been able to work here and do what I've done here in the years, all the different things, has been absolutely fantastic for me. People have been saying to me, and Ian Meldrum is one of the main people, he used to give me hell. And say, you've got to go, you've got to crack overseas, you must do this, why haven't you done it? And I got a lot of pressure because of that from all sorts of areas. And it seemed more important to other people than it was to me. I'm very happy with what happened here.
Mm.
The rest of the success has been absolutely fantastic, and I've loved every minute of it.
But it really hasn't been the most important thing in my life.
Well, it's probably
I live here.
What's kept you sane?
Yeah, I think so, probably.
Because certainly you'd appear in a Royal Command performance at the opening opera house or things like that, and just do a knockout performance, and then suddenly you'd be back doing the clubs again after that.
Yeah.
Instead of somewhere, we'd see others unnamed people go overseas.
Yeah, but that's the nature of the business.
Successes.
That's the nature of the business. When you say that I am a singer, I mean, I'm not in the industry to impress other singers or mm-hmm. to do any of that. That's I just want to make music that's accessible to people. I enjoy to sing. And I'll have a go at anything,
Yeah. Did anyone ever say to you, Molly as well, ever say, look, you're simply too nice for this business?
I get that a lot.
Do you?
But that's okay. I don't really care about that.
Oh.
I am fairly easy to get along with. I don't see any reason to stamp my feet on the ground and jump up and down like a rat bag. I think that's childish.
Good idea.
So I don't really see the need for any of that. I get Molly's occasionally, I can throw my dummy in the dirt, but it's pretty rare.
Yeah. Looking at you two sitting there side by side is a great sight. You're both Australian icons. I mean, the last time we really saw you two together was at the Olympics.
Everybody's an icon now. I mean, there are so many Devons, icons and legends around. You only have to be in the business for 8 minutes.
Well, we'll agree to disagree on that.
I was being facetious. Thank you.
You two are both very special. I mean, those concerts, the main event, when you two were there with Anthony Waller, tell me how much fun it was, the three of you getting up there night after night.
It was great, wasn't it?
It was an amazing experience. And I have to say, I mean, we were asked, in no uncertain terms, to do that again. I think we all really would have loved to have done it again. I know I would have. But I don't know whether we could have actually topped it.
It's a hard act to follow.
Yeah. Real tough to follow, and I would rather people remember it, or this is my feeling, remember it as it was. What I was frightened of with that whole thing is people walking away from main event again, if you will, or the second round,
second
or whatever they're going to call it, would have gone, it wasn't as good as the first time.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, and that first time is always, something I'll never forget.
Yeah.
I wish I hadn't said that.
Me?
Oh, yep.
Okay. John, what would be your favourite song that you've ever recorded? I know that's a hard question.
Yeah,
but...
it is. Let's play the answer for me. No. Oh, no. Shut up! No! Shut up! Shut up! You shut me up! Shut up!
No. This bloke works for us as well.
No, actually, I mean, Sadie would be... I'm very fond of Sadie, even though I don't want to sing it right now. It's like asking me which one of my kids I love the best. You know, I love each song that I get to sing in different ways, and some of them I love for different reasons. But, it's particularly now, I think, since Uncovered, which was the album that had a help on it, which started it for me, started to make me pull my socks up and start working at what I do.
Yeah.
Particularly since then, it would be really hard for me to put my finger on one. There are special songs that, I mean, You're the Voice is obviously a very special thing for me, and Help is a very special song for me, but they're not necessarily my favourites,
So do you check people, you drop into a mate's place, oh, John, good to see you, come on in. Do you automatically look at taps and,
Oh, no, some of them might have a leaky...
Yeah, do you check the tension on the taps?
I don't do that anymore.
You don't advise them? You don't say, look, you turned it off too hard. You don't have to do that.
No. I'll fix a dripping tap or unblock a toilet if they've got a wire coat hanger.
Yeah.
I'm quite happy.
Stilsons, do you use Stilsons?
I used to be pretty handy with a pair of Stilsons, actually, yeah.
Do you keep a pair? Some Stilsons in there?
Yeah, actually, still got all my plumbing tools at home.
Just in case the musical career clags
just
out.
Just in case.
You're an enthusiastic smoker. In fact, I find it very hard to believe that it's only recently that you've given up.
Yeah, I gave up 4 years ago.
4 years ago. Yeah. And how did you go about it? And what advice do you have people who are trying to get off the...
Well, there's nothing worse than a reformed smoker. I mean,
no, I know that.
The pain in the ass, but I wish I hadn't said that. Yeah. But if you don't want to smoke, don't. And I got to the stage where I gave myself a month. And actually, it was during Superstar, funnily enough. I should have given up in LRB, I guess. But I gave myself a month, and I stopped on that. I don't actually remember having a last one. I used to smoke 80 a day. Stupid habit.
Ooh.
Filthy habit, too. It's not, terribly antisocial now.
Yeah.
But I gave up cold turkey, and
I will never put myself through that first 2 weeks again, or my family, quite honestly.
Yeah.
It's a very hard thing to do.
They say it's harder
than
hell.
My self-esteem went, you know. Yeah, well, they reckon it is.
Yeah.
Well, Wheatley tells me it is.
Yeah.
And what's the future hold? You know, obviously, you'd be not keen to go out on another Harry and Miller project, you know, not to be unkind to
Harry.
Well,
we're getting LRB back together again to go... No. I've got the opening of the casino in Melbourne, which is my next project, which I'm looking forward to very much.
Yeah.
We've got Kylie Minogue coming out for that, which should be a lot of fun. Ray Charles is coming out for that, which will be great fun.
And, are you going to sing with Ray Charles?
I'd like to, yeah. I'm actually going into Adelaide tomorrow to meet with him. And,
right. What was it like singing with Stevie Wonder? Because you, when he was on tour, you sang with him just about every night, I think.
Yeah. I probably have to fight some of the band, but I'm probably Stevie Wonder's biggest fan. I love what he does with his voice. You know, some of the material, I guess, as it lets us all down sometimes, but I just think his voice is amazing.
He oversings, doesn't he?
Absolutely.
And on that technical note, it's time to wish John all the very best for the casino opening and a hit-filled future. And I ask everyone, whether they're at home or here in the Painting Rocks, to get them out and clang them together as a way of thanking John Farnham.
Let's talk about Europe. We've heard a fair bit about that. Again, we would think that given your success here with the album, that you just walked into Europe and they welcome you with open arms. Wasn't the case.
Well, it felt like that. It really did, because the record was released here and started to do all that work, and then...
This was a Munich concert, by the way, from the Willis program.
What a day that was.
110,000 people?
Yeah. I wish I was getting a dollar a head. That was an amazing show. That was with Chris de Burgh and Joe Cocker and Robert Cray, who's coming out here shortly. It's a great band if anyone's watching. Let's go see Robert Cray. It's great. And it was the first time I performed on the German stage live. And there was 110,000 people out there, and I think 99% of them knew the words to the song.
Really?
It was just fantastic.
But you had done, in fact, the reason I said it wasn't easy was that was your fourth or fifth trip to Europe.
Oh, yeah, we'd been backwards and forwards a great deal.
So you'd been actually doing the talk shows, doing the radio.
Tours, yeah, all that sort of thing. I think the most horrendous trip we had, I went for a holiday, for a two-week holiday, and I got back and Glenn Wheatley, my manager, rang me and said, look, leave some clothes in your suitcase because there's a good chance at 6 o'clock tonight I'll get a call from London telling us that we have to leave on a midnight flight. So I was there shaking sand out of my jeans, you know. So, oh, no, I've got to go. And we got a call, and we left at midnight that night, and we were there for 2 days, or 30 hours or something. We were on the ground, or in the air longer than we were on the ground. I went over to do Top of the Pops, which is a television show.
In Britain, right.
Yeah, in London. And it was election day, the day of the program. Apparently, they normally take the program the day before and put it out the next day, and the whole affair. But because of the election, they didn't do that. The show went out live to 90 million people, and they told me about that, and I went blind. It was unbelievable. I instantly forgot all the words of the song, Jeff, and I didn't know where I was. And on the Willissey thing, I made a crack about my mother-in-law, who's a wonderful human being.
Here's your big chance to strike her
up. No, see, people get offended by that sometimes, and they shouldn't. She is a dog, but she's all right. She's all right. And I would never get away with that stuff if she thought I meant it.
There you go, John. Talk your way out of that.
Giving me some more rope, eh? Right. No, actually, I heard a lovely, lovely gag while I was away about this guy whose mother-in-law had started talking through her nose because she wore her mouth out, which I'm going to use.
Any more time you'd like, John?
No, thanks, mate. I'm set now. I'm a dead man.
What about people from the our representatives from the Soviet Union here? And
yes, I did.
Doing a
good evening,
job.
Ladies.
Good evening. Hi.
Hi.
How are you?
Fine, thank you. And
good.
You?
Particularly well. And I, the only Russian word I know is spasibo, which is thank you, and I really mean that from the bottom of my heart. See, I'm married, but I'm not dead. I mean, this is serious.
Aren't they gorgeous?
Yeah.
They are top models from Moscow.
Right, exactly.
I was in Moscow. I didn't see you there.
You would have remembered. When were you in Moscow?
I'll never forget it. I was there. Oh, I can't remember, but I was there.
Fantastic. Can you still do plumbing or not?
Yeah, I can keep my hand in, if you'll pardon the expression. I can fix. You know, I mean, I don't do any roughing in work or anything. Oh, yeah. I still know the lingo though. But I can fix a leaky tap or a broken dunny, and I can still get my arm like that.
Once you know it.
You do that once, it's something you never forget.
Johnny. How are you, mate?
Couldn't see
Patrick
you.
Lindsay. Traveling incognito.
We're drooping mesmerized.
Well, it's just another gig with 4 billion people.
That's all right. Yeah, thank you very much. I'm putting them back on there. It's going to be interesting. I don't think I've ever been so toey.
Really?
And I get pretty toey when I work, but this one's got me, I think.
I'm trying
not to drop the blonde, though. That's what I'm worried about. I'm worried about dropping the other singer. Because at one of the rehearsals, I let it go, and the ground's very uneven, and she tripped. Oops. So don't blame me for dropping the blonde.
What are you going to do to calm down just before?
Oh, I'll be absolutely drunk. No, I'm okay. No, I'm with power. No, I don't know. I mean, what I normally do is just spend a few minutes on my own, have a few breaths, and just take it easy. It's interesting out the back there because they've got all these guys that are giving us cues, and the very first rehearsal, we were out there 10 minutes before we were due to sing. It's nippy out there as well. Olivia's wearing, you know, a handkerchief. I've got a suit on, so it's not so bad for me, but you kind of lose any impact that might be there. So we've been trying to pare that down a little bit. So I'll be nervously trying to get this guy to just wait. So we'll see what happens.
Good on you, mate. Everyone will be behind you. We're going to have a big time.
Oh, it's going to be a big party, I tell you. I might have a beer after this, I think.
I was just focusing on not tripping up on the way down the stairs, and just the people that were there. The excitement and the feeling was so amazing in there. You couldn't think beyond it. It was fantastic.
Yeah, that's pretty much how I felt. I'm concentrating on trying not to drop Olivia, and just soaking up what was happening to us. To be able to walk in among the athletes, we were told that that's never been done before, and We really took something from that. To be able to look these people in the eyes while they were in that particular venue at that time was just an absolute joy. I'll never forget it.
Smile.
I mean, Julie and I get on particularly well. We really do get on very well indeed. And I can get a bit snippy occasionally, and she can get a bit snippy about 12 times a year. I must give a cause. I reckon it was her mother's fault. She was the last one to have her.
I thought you did very well as JC had me convinced. I'm nearly flatulated. Yeah. Is that a word? What do you do when you do that?
Can you flat?
No wonder I'm asked.
She'll make it for Christmas.
No wonder I'm asked to leave parties. I do apologise.
No, it was fabulous. I liked it a lot.
God.
If you've got your tape on, folks, you just got a beauty. That was a snorter.
Oh, I do apologise.
Oh,
for that.
No,
sorry,
I liked it.
Oh, stop it, I'm terrible. Okay,
what about America? Have you tried America?
Yes, the record was released in America, and the only way I can explain the situation is, like, America has 270 million people. The European continent has about 290 million people. But it's very segmented. And the way the record started in Europe was it went up the charts in Holland, then went into Sweden, then went into Germany, and from Germany fanned out across the rest of the continent. America doesn't really have those lines, and it's a world within itself. It really is.
Mm.
And they just couldn't pigeonhole the song. They didn't know whether it was AOR or CHR or RRRR. Or, you know, they just couldn't put it in a pigeonhole. So we've pulled You're the Voice,
and we're putting Pressure Down out as the next single. And they think that, or the record companies seem to think that that can work, and we'll possibly release You're the Voice later on.
Is there any chance, unless the record's out and on Top of the Pops, any chance of doing the Johnny Carson or the talk shows? You've got to wait for those to happen.
I don't know. I guess I'll have to wait.
I was thinking that's the way that Paul Hogan went, except for that to flog the movie.
Hogan's so big over there, it's unbelievable. I got to Sweden, this killed me. I got to Sweden and I sat down with this woman called Stina, who's quite a heavy interviewer. I mean, she, the week before, had done an interview with Princess Caroline. And the first question was, do you still feel guilty about your mother's death? I mean, it's, oh. And they told me I was being interviewed by this woman. So I went in and she jumped all over me. You male chauvinist pigs over there in Australia and this, that and the other. And I went, why? And apparently they'd misinterpreted Hogan's sense of humour, which is not easy to do. And he had said, or what they thought he said was, you know, if an Australian man had been asked by his woman to do the washing up or a bit of ironing, we'd slap him down.
And then he left
Maybe
town.
Maybe she was right.
He left town and you came in.
He left town and I came in and got snotted all over. I mean, they were jumping all over me. So I said, look, I want to see this tape. Get me a copy of the tape, and if that's the case, then I'll disagree with Paul and maybe we'll have an argument about it. Anyway, they sent me the tape and the man was being funny. But I said, no, Paul Hogan is a comedian, you know. Was he in his hoax? Did he have his shorts on? And they said, no, he had a suit on and he was serious. But he was kidding. must have been kidding.
Next time you see Hoax, you owe him one.
I do.
Congratulations again on last night, mate.
Thanks, Ray.
Lovely to talk to you and we look forward to the... What's next? I mean, are you simply just going to take a rest?
Yes, I'm going to take a rest. I'm doing another television show next week.
Don't mention that.
No way.
No.
And then I'm going to have a couple of weeks off and then I'll probably go into rehearsals. We're doing another Australian concert tour.
Fabulous.
Which I'm really looking forward to. We're going to go all out in this one. And then...
You mean you didn't on the other one?
Well, yeah, we did, but we have to do it better this time. And I'll have to learn some new
stuff. Do you feel that
pressure? Stuff. I think so. Oh, yeah.
That you've got to somehow beat the voice?
You're asking for a lot of money. I mean, because those places are so expensive to run, we the expenses are very high. So, you know, you're asking for $23 to $25 to sometimes $30 a ticket. And so, you have to give them something back.
It's what people pay for the best overseas, and you're certainly the best here.
Yeah, but, well, we'll be a bit cheaper than that.
And the winner is...
John Farnham for Age of Reason.
Yeah!
Age of Reason, the title track of John Farnham's top-selling album. The video is shot at Cathedral Mount in Victoria and directed by Steve Hopkins, produced by Stephen Priest.
Thank you very much indeed. First of all, I'd like to thank Robbie Wellington. Robbie shot the clip. He made me look good. We used mountaineer socks on the lenses. Thanks for laughing at that. It's great. The band have been absolutely unbelievable. I really want to thank those people very much. I love them very much, and they are among the finest musicians and singers you can find. In fact, David Hirschfelder, who works with me often, is doing the music for you tonight, and I think he's done a great job. The crew, all the people I work with. There, David! Hang on, it wasn't Robbie Wellington's clip, it was Age of Reason. I'm sorry, I thought you said Two Strong Hearts. Wish I was dead.
I didn't want to start.
Somebody said he's close down there. No, actually, it was... Thank you very much. Oh! Stephen Priest. I'll start again. Thank you so
let's
much.
Let's do it from there. Let's do it from there. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the stage, John Farnham. Congratulations. Look, just do what Michael Cole did many years ago. Just treat this as a dress rehearsal.
I've seriously considered it. Stephen Priest produced the clip and Steve Hopkins filmed it. They did a wonderful job, as did Robbie Wellington on Two Strong Hearts.
Happy to get David again too.
And David Hirschfelder actually was also there. Because this is sort of deja vu. I do apologise. It's the hair. It's taken all the brain food out. It's just, it makes me look young and fresh. I can't help it. But thank you very, very much indeed. I'm a very proud man. Thank you, Glenn Wheatley, my manager. Thanks for the bride and my sons for putting up with me. And thanks for the pilot for bringing me here tonight. And thank you very, very much. It's good to see you, Bert.
Good to see you too, mate. Thank you. John Farnham.
Talking about being on the road, one of the tracks on the album was written about being on the road, wasn't it?
Yes, yeah. Burn For You, which is the ballad on the piece, was real. Yeah, Ross Fraser, who produced the albums, and Phil Buckle, who's playing guitar, he's the one with the ponytail, or the older one of the three guitarists. He and I and Ross wrote the song, and it was written about our women. You know, I mean, our wives get left behind more often than not when we go away. And it really does, I don't know about you, but my wife gets into a self-preservation thing, you know, after a while, after I've been away. I mean, the first few days, it's, oh, I love you, I wish you'd come home. And the second day, it's, oh, please come home. You know, the kids are driving me crazy. And the third period of time is, I hate you. You're always leaving me. And hang out, you know. And it goes in cycles. There's the bride now.
Where is she?
Good kiss, that woman. Damn good kiss, Julie.
Whereabouts?
Oh, well, what's she doing to me there? I think I remember
there,
that.
There. What was happening there?
I don't know, but I've got a feeling it wasn't very pleasant. Might have been just after the operation.
What's...
Oh!
The operation?
Yes, yeah.
Tell us about the operation.
I had a minor operation. I'm over 40, you can guess what it was. During the album. Yeah, I'm shooting blanks. What was it? Vasectomy. It's done, isn't it? I said vasectomy on television.
Say it again. What was the, Just show us.
Just tell those Russian girls that. Yeah, let's tell them. Anyway...
Settle down, girls. Yeah. Don't just take
And no, I actually had the minor operation. I wish I'd have stuck with it, really. During the album. And
during the album?
Yes, during the album. And I waited for a couple of weeks for it to settle down, because it's not a very pleasant thing to go through.
And, is it a minor operation?
Well, yeah. That's what the guy told me who did
it. Before you went
in. His name was Cleve.
Dr. Cleve?
Dr. Cleve. Or Mr. Cleve, I think, you know. It's
a surgeon,
Warner.
Yeah.
Because I went in and he said, oh, you don't look like the type, because I was being really cool, you know, yeah, Cleavey, I'm here and I'm going to have my operation. Lovely man. And I'm standing there with my trousers down around my knees, he's going like, and I'm thinking, and I actually said to him, I said, shouldn't you kiss me while you're doing this? Seriously. Man's got, no. No, I actually said it. I'm laying on the table, you know, covered in a sheet with one of them backless things on, which is a bit nippy if you're walking around.
But a rather attractive little thing.
Yeah, cute little backless number. Yeah. And he said, how do you feel? And Gillian actually got, oh, maybe I shouldn't tell
you. Well, Gillian's in there.
No, Gillian wasn't in there.
Gillian's in there, isn't
Gillian,
she?
Gillian
she's
got
in
me.
There.
Yeah, she, oh, she's in there, all right. She, no problems whatsoever. And she actually got me a movie that she thought, you know, the night before, because I was a bit toey about it, the night before, and she got me Great Balls of Fire, which is...
we're going to take a break. I'm with John Farnham. Stick around. This is live.
I've seen you. How's the vasectomy holding up?
It's fine. Still working.
Is it? Or not?
Actually, I had the horrors when you said you were going to start playing, you know, bits from the old shows. I thought, oh, I'm going to have to live through the bloody vasectomy again, you know. The revelation thereof.
That's right. John came onto television and thought he was going to... It was a family show, talk about all sorts of things, and we were about... What, three questions in?
Yeah, and I just went for it. Oh!
For no reason, right, John started talking about the vasectomy.
Which was... Yeah, well, and I can't top that unless I get it out, but I'm not...
I'll save that for the third segment, mate.
We have a great country, we have a great leader here, and also we have a great Australian of the Year, to John Farnham. Congratulations.
Radios as well as me.
Thank you very much indeed. Hang on. I'm very rarely serious in front of a microphone, but
today I'm going to try really hard. I've lived in this country... I'm going to cry. This is stupid. Hang on. Can I have a glass of your... Can I borrow your champagne? Thank you very much indeed. It's all right, I got one. Thank you, sir. Here's the other side. I've lived in this country for most of my life and have no desire to live anywhere else. Australia has been home to me and my family. It's where our heart is. I'm proud to bring my children up here. But that doesn't mean that I don't think about the rest of the world, the rest of the globe, because I believe that we as a species must look at our collective backyard, because if we despoil what we have, we can't just move next door. We can't find another paddock to build a house on. So Australia does deserve national pride. We are right. Hang on. We are right to instill national pride in our children. But please, let's make our national pride encompass humanity. Thank you very much indeed.
Welcome back to Good Morning Australia, live from Kirribilli House, where the Australian of the Year has just been announced. And if we get in very quickly, you're going to hear just a few words being sung from John Farnham, especially asked for by our Prime Minister.
For that special touch of paradise. Just a touch of paradise. Just a special touch of paradise.
Will that do? I don't think I can do any more.
I'm not normally a depressed type of human being. I'm usually fairly happy. You know, it's that old quote of Sam Seas, who wrote Reasons. Sam once said to me, he said, you'll never write a good song, Farnham, you're always too bloody happy. And he's probably right, because Sam has to be, you know, in the depths of despair to write a song. So he walks around, you know, hitting himself in the face with a cricket bat to make him feel bad, so he can write a song. But I went through the floor after I finished this record. I it mattered to me, I think, more than anything else. Not that it was a success, necessarily, but that it would get a fair look at, fair listen to, by the people who have the preconceptions.
That we were driving home from the office and we first went number one, I was driving the car and he was sitting in the passenger seat next to me, and I was saying, John, do you understand, you know, I'm driving along, we've got the number one album in the country, the number one. We are selling more records than anybody else in this country this week. It's our week, can you believe that? And he was silent. I looked around and he had a tear in his cheeks.